Audible? Yes. I'd like to thank Daksha Legal for giving me this opportunity to discuss such an important topic and share my limited thoughts and my limited knowledge with the members of the audience. I'll try and do justice to the mandate that's been given to me. But before that, just a few clarifications. Yes, this is fine. Yeah. There's a decent chance that I could be repeating a few things that I've said before whenever the issue of Sabarimala is discussed. And I say that primarily because, regardless of my training as an intellectual property lawyer, I believe seriously in the importance of attribution. And there is no, how do I put this? A discussion on Sabarimala is incomplete without discussing the submissions of Mr. K. Parasaran. And he was the Bhishma Pitama who effectively led our side. That doesn't necessarily make us the Kauravas, but be that as it may, given his sagacity and given his thorough gentlemanly nature as a person, it was an education both as a lawyer and as a human being to watch him in action. So I think the credit must first go to Mr. K. Parasaran for having laid the foundation for whatever I argued subsequently. And I was clearly standing on the shoulders of giants. So the credit must first go to the giants. I'm a nobody as far as the profession is concerned when you compare me with people like Mr. K. Parasaran. The fact that my name finds mention in the judgment alongside his name itself is for me a huge achievement, and I consider that as a huge achievement. So that credit is something that must go. And most importantly, I would always credit the women of People for Dharma for having given me an opportunity to represent their cause in this matter. Because this is not about men, this was about women. Let's be very, very clear about that. So that's point number two. Point number three, just a small correction. I started at 12:54, just before lunch. I concluded at 1 o'clock. I was asked to continue for 20 minutes from 2 o'clock. I concluded at 3:40. So I spoke close to 2 hours, not 30 minutes. Just a clarification, just to put that on record. And this is not to brag, but this is to say that notwithstanding the outcome and the judgment with which I have serious reservations and objections, I'm grateful to the court for having given literally a bacha in the profession an opportunity to submit. So that is something that I would never forget. So that's point number two. Point number three is there's a decent chance that people who are aware of my views may assume that my legal interpretation with respect to Article 370 is heavily influenced by, let's call it, my ideology or whatever it may be. But the one thing that I have done to the best of my abilities is to keep my biases, my political proclivities, or my ideological proclivities, and my civilizational leanings aside, and try to focus on this particular issue exclusively and solely as a lawyer. So I'll try and do justice to the mandate. You can call me out if you think I'm being hypocritical somewhere, I'll respond to that, okay? How many lawyers do we have here? Students, practitioners, okay, that's a good number. So I'm going to try and keep this as interesting as possible for both the legal audience as well as the non-legal audience. So just keep pace with me because there is a lot that I'm going to reel out. And whatever I thought I knew of this particular provision, most of these preconceived notions were shattered when I started going through the history of the entire thing. And in fact, I realized that there is so much I did not know. And a good number of my positions were perhaps even half-baked. And my research now tells me that perhaps I know something about it and there is a lot more to be known about it, okay? And the references that I have read so far, and it's important to, let's give the footnotes first. I've read the book partly by the former governor of Kashmir, Mr. Jagmohan, who was the governor at the relevant point of time when there was an exodus of Kashmiri Hindus from the state of Jammu and Kashmir. His book called Frozen. In fact, I read the 12th edition. It's an extremely important book. Chapter 6 of that particular book, which is titled Roots, Article 370, where he traces the origin of the current dispute and the current controversy in Kashmir to Article 370. That's an important book to read. I'm just giving pointers for research so that people know what to read once they go back, because I'm sure I can't capture this particular topic or do justice to it in an hour or 2 hours. I have ammunition for 7 hours now, but I know I have to keep it for 2 hours now. So point number two is a fantastic book, even though I disagree with him on a lot of issues, by Sri A.G. Noorani on Article 370, on the constitutional history of Article 370. That's a book that is a must read. Whether you agree with a certain position or not, it's always important to know, let's call it, the opponent's position, and then argue. even if it makes for difficult and perhaps cringing reading. But be that as it may, somebody's written, somebody's done their research, and they presented their point of view. It's important to read and then respond. Three is a book that I did not know existed until 2 weeks ago when I ordered it and then I started reading it. It's a fantastic book by Srimati Radha Rajan, where she effectively captures the unknown history of Article 370 by a document, I mean through a document, a 22-page document, authored by Mr. Ramachandra Kak, who was the Prime Minister between 48 to 50 of Kashmir under Sri Hari Singh. And what was his point of view with respect to the undercurrents and the dynamics of the politics of 370? So that's a very important read. In fact, it's astounding research. It gives you a ringside view of what exactly was happening at that point of time. Apart from that, there is a beautiful book runs into about 344 pages on this website called I Kashmir. You may not want to read the opinion pieces written on that depending on which side of the fence you stand as far as this issue is concerned. But they have compiled all the legal documents relating to this, starting from the Treaty of Amritsar of 1842. So that is, in fact, 344 pages during the court. Of course, we keep waiting for matters. I try to read it as much as possible and I've tried to assimilate it. So that's one important resource. The good part is it captures right until the UN resolutions and thereafter, all of that. So you also have to read, when you read Article 370, you have to read the Constitution of Jammu and Kashmir of 1956, because these two go hand in hand. And if you look for Article 35A in any bare act of the Indian Constitution, you will never find it, because it comes as a consequence of the presidential order of 1954, where the Constitution was, or certain provisions of the Constitution were applied to the state of Jammu and Kashmir. These are different things that I've read. Then, of course, there's a paper on integration of states, a white paper which was released in the 1950s, when India was being formed, so to speak, by Mr. Sardar Vallabhai Patel and his right-hand man, V.P. Menon. So this is another book that you must read. There could be several other books, but this has been my primary research. Then, of course, about 16 to 17 judgments of the Supreme Court on Articles 35A, on Article 370, and on application of different laws of India to Jammu and Kashmir, which involves necessarily a discussion of Article 370. So these are several different judgments. One of the earliest judgments starts in 1959, Premnath Kaul versus something. You start with that. And then right until the 2016 judgment of the Supreme Court, I think this was on the issue of application of the Sarfaisi Act to the state of Jammu and Kashmir, where an analysis of Article 370 was necessary. So I've tried to read as much as possible on this, and at least 35 to 40 documents, important documents, which I felt were extremely important. Now I'll come to the topic. So there's a decent chance that I may run from one place to another like a monkey jumping between different trees, but the idea is to connect the dots. So try and keep pace with me. Not that I'm fast. I speak fast perhaps because it's a slow brain which takes time to process. Okay? So it's possible to start the discussion on Article 370 by simply reading the provision. You could perhaps start saying, look at this provision, look at this provision. It's so crystal clear. Frankly, it's not, according to me. The provision, when I read it, raised hundreds of questions in my head, and I realized that I would be doing injustice to the mandate, or at least the discussion with respect to this issue, unless and until I read the history of this particular issue. And this is not something that is peculiar to research on Article 370. According to me, this is equally applicable to any research on any constitutional provision, because there's a serious backdrop, there's a context to it. And perhaps it applies to any other legislation outside the Constitution, but especially to the Constitution. So anybody who wants to comment on Article 370, at the very least, must read certain documents which date back to 1930s, if not the 1800s, and then proceed to understand what was the context in which this entire provision was crafted and drafted and carved out in the Constitution. What is the meaning of this? What exactly were the dynamics at the negotiating table when the different parties were talking to each other? Who are the different parties, in fact, makes a huge, for a huge reading. So just a few timelines, so just bear with me. Jammu and Kashmir as an entity as we know it today, in terms of, let's say, both POK as well as the area that was ceded to China in 1963, all put together, were carved out as a consequence of a treaty, which is called the Treaty of Amritsar, which was entered into in 1846. And this was between the Dogra Rajputs, then by Maharaja Gulab Singh, representing the Dogra Rajput clan, and the then Governor General of India, I think it was the Right Honorable Hardinge, I think after whom the Hardinge Medical University or the college is set up in Delhi, perhaps that is the connect. So these are the two people. And that particular document captures multiple things. I think the purchase price of this particular state at that point of time was 75 lakh rupees, not Indian rupees, but Nanakshahi rupees, which was being followed in the Sikh Empire. So that was the price at which this particular piece of land was purchased by the Dogra Rajputs from the British. Now, how do they define Kashmir? Because now we are talking of trifurcation of Kashmir, Ladakh and all that. So it's important to understand when you speak of Kashmir, what is the standard geographical entity that comes to mind and what has it been associated with? East of one river, west of another river. East of which river? Ravi? And what is west of what? So, no, Sindhu and Ravi you have, and then you have the Chamba Valley in between. So, which is why a good portion of even what we know as Himachal Pradesh today could perhaps form part of this region. So, this is the geographical identification. But what is important to know before that is that Ladakh was captured in 1834, that is at least 12 years before the formation of Kashmir. Okay. That is one of the reasons that the traditional position of people from Ladakh has been that when you speak of Kashmir, do not include Ladakh. That there is a reason for it. In fact, there is a fantastic letter that was written by the president of the Buddhist Association of Ladakh around the time of the accession, when Kashmir was still deciding whether it wants to go green or whether it wants to go the tricolor way. Okay, it was still asking itself this question. They wrote that no matter what the decision of people of Kashmir, Ladakh wants to be with India. That's the position that they took. This is something that you will see. Okay. So what is important is they acquired this particular state or it was carved out. So this was for all practical purposes like any other princely state. So when you discuss princely states, India was divided into what? British India and princely states. So when you speak of British India, it excludes princely states. It only includes what was then known as provinces. So you have the United Provinces or the Presidency, so on and so forth. But it excludes princely states. Okay? What is the direct consequence of this? Princely states do not have a relationship with the Viceroy or the Governor. They have a direct relationship with the Crown at that point of time. Because they are seen as feudatories of the Crown. They are in alliance with the Crown. Therefore, they are subject to that what is known as, in all these documents, the paramount power at that point of time, which is the crown. Whereas each of these provinces were directly reporting to either the Governor General or the Viceroy. And they were reporting to the Majesty, so to speak, His Majesty or Her Majesty, whoever at that particular point of time, through the Secretary of State appointed for India. This is the broad relationship. Why does all of this matter? Because when you speak of the independence movement in India, you're largely speaking of the provinces and not the states. This is important. And how it affects the question relating to Kashmir is something that you will see as I go along. So what happens is the state is formed. The state has an alliance. So I think effectively there were four Rajas under this particular dynasty, starting with Maharaja Gulab Singh, then his son Ranbir Singh, then his son Pratap Singh, in between his brother Amar Singh, and then goes back to Pratap Singh, and then from there, Raja Hari Singh. This is effectively the period until 1952. This is the dynasty until 1952, starting from 1846 to 1952. What you have to realize is, Kashmir as a princely state underwent serious introspections much prior to the question of accession. The question of accession effectively started only after the concept of two dominions, which is Pakistan and India came about in 1946. Until then, Kashmir itself was going through severe churn because of multiple reasons. What are those multiple reasons? One is the crown effectively wanted the king or successive kings to initiate constitutional reforms because according to them, the dynasty was not doing a particularly great job of administering the place and it was suffering from serious poverty. Now, there is a decent chance that these representations are motivated. I am not taking any particular position. I am simply saying what I have deciphered from British documents. There is always a possibility that you take it not with a pinch of salt, but with a bag of salt. Be there as it may, their position was that this particular princely state must slowly transition towards a constitutional setup. which is why the constitution of Jammu and Kashmir is not traceable to 1956, but they had a constitution much before, in 1934. And before that, you had concepts of Praja Sabha, so on and so forth, because people said, look, we don't think you're doing a great job of it. And the crown had written on multiple occasions to the king, saying, you need to involve your people in the administration of this particular place. So how did the transition come about? So from a monarchy, it became a diarchy, which means there's a power sharing with the king at the top and two representatives chosen from the common population, one Hindu and one Muslim. That is how it started. But people felt that this was still a puppet form of government with practically all power with the king and with these popular ministers not having too much of a mandate. So that resulted in further push for reforms. Around this point of time, local leaders and local population starts giving rise to leaders. So among the most popular leaders that we know of today is Sheikh Mohammed Abdullah, who started off the National Conference. So you have the National Conference, which is a political player within the princely state of Kashmir. Then you have the dynasty. Then there is a third element that comes about subsequently, which is known as the Muslim Conference. Okay, you have to understand how these players work, because I'll show what their arguments were and what exactly were their own vested interests. So National Conference and Muslim Conference, what is the difference? Muslim Conference very clearly believed that the two-nation theory applies, and therefore, since it's a Muslim majority state, at the very least, it must be independent of India, whether or not it accedes to Pakistan. That was effectively the position of these people. Whereas the National Conference effectively believed that even if we don't accede to either of these two places, we must be a secular democratic state. At least that was the statement made. We don't know whether that was intended or meant, but I'm just taking it on face value. And therefore, they opted for a constitutional setup. This was effectively the position of the National Conference. I'm telling you the difference in positions between these two parties. Whereas the king believed, as most princely states, that at the end of the day, they must not lose their privileges and they must have some say in the administration and they must have the ability to call the shots when it comes to important issues. These are the dramatis personae before, let's say, the rest of India interferes. Just keep it this way. These are the three parties, effectively. Mr. Jinnah has not entered the picture, Nehru has not entered the picture, Gandhi has not entered the picture so far. These are only the three people. The most important sessions, according to me, which effectively set the ball rolling towards the fructification of the idea of Pakistan, are the Allahabad session and the Lahore session, one in 1930s and the other in 1940s. You should read the speech of Sir Muhammad Iqbal on why he believed that the two-nation theory is ultimately important. In fact, he is seen as the founder of that particular concept way before Jinnah, obviously, for all practical reasons, Allama Iqbal. And so these are the people who effectively set the ball rolling to say, from an idea, this must translate to reality. What was the basis of their belief? All of this matters because it affects the current politics of Kashmir. They believed that Hindus and Muslims are two different nations, as a consequence of which they cannot exist under each other or with each other, that coexistence was practically impossible. And one of the justifications that they gave was, we worship a certain set of heroes who, according to you, are enemies. So you may worship Aurangzeb, we may hate Aurangzeb. Let's put it in contemporary terms. Okay. Therefore, we do not have a shared idea of the past. And therefore, we do not have a shared idea of the present. Consequently, you cannot have a shared idea of the future. That is effectively the position of the people who stood or who supported the two-nation theory. There were people from both sides, including Mr. Ambedkar, who was a supporter and a votary of the two-nation theory, for which you should read his book, Pakistan or the Partition of India, where he's very, very clear about the fact that these two communities cannot live together. In fact, he had very serious positions with respect to the composition of the Indian army with non-Hindus. He was very, very clear about the fact. In fact, he took the position that perhaps in the interest of protecting India's security, future India must try and ensure that it is not populated by too many non-Hindus. That was his position. That's not my position. You can read the book. Okay? So a lot of people who keep citing Ambedkar for all the wrong reasons, I think they should read what he's written. Okay? So this was his position. Now, what happens then is, once the idea of Pakistan is effectively put on the table, it affects multiple things, which is what? Assume for a moment that the British decide to leave the country. The question is, what is the way of the future? Are we creating two dominions or are we creating one dominion? Because the discussion had already started with respect to a constituent assembly. If ultimately there are going to be two different dominions, you can't have a single constituent assembly taking a decision on behalf of those two dominions, right? So in 1946, when the constituent assembly comes out for the very first time, by that time, the idea of Pakistan is effectively on the table. There is no running away from the particular concept at all. One clearly says, I will not be a part of any decision with respect to a future Indian constitution because I do not wish to be a part of Hindu majority India. That was the position taken by Mr. Jinnah. Okay. In fact, here's an important thing that people must realize. So Mr. Jinnah tries to woo the people of Kashmir, and let's be blunt, he wants to woo the Muslims of Kashmir. He makes an appeal, he tries and makes an effort to reach out to them. Now when this happens, so effectively this is a situation with two swords in a single scabbard, which is the National Conference, Sheikh Abdullah wants to be the representative of Muslims of Kashmir and all people of Kashmir, not just the Muslims of Kashmir. Jinnah wants to effectively represent only the Muslims of Kashmir, promising, of course, secularism, equality, and everything for the namesake as far as the non-Muslims of Kashmir are concerned. That is, of course, that's something he did. Now, the point is, these two people never got along. This is something that most people don't even know. Because each of them wants to be the sole representative. One wants to be the sole representative of Muslims of Kashmir, whereas the other wants to be the sole representative of the entire Kashmir state. That's the difference. In fact, to the extent that there are paragraphs where Jinnah says that Sheikh Abdullah, whenever he talks to me, he starts with swear words and abuses. Okay, that is the level of acrimony between these two people. Okay? So if National Conference does not wish to go with Mr. Jinnah in Pakistan, so which is the party which obviously wants to go with Jinnah in Pakistan? The Muslim Conference, right? So you will find multiple speeches of members of the Muslim Conference, I think, who still have successors who are important political members in Kashmir's polity today, who shared the view of Mr. Jinnah, and who clearly said, we cannot be a part of a Hindu majority state under any circumstances. This is against the teachings of Islam. That was their position. They were very, very blunt about it. Okay? Now, while all of this happens, so Sardar Patel starts talking to multiple states, and then the Union of India slowly starts taking shape. All of this happens under what? If a state wants to join either Pakistan or India, there must be some legal basis for it. It's not just volition. Here, two important legislations play a very important role. The Government of India Act of 1935, subsequently replaced by the Government of India Act of 1947. Specifically, the provision of both these instruments which deal with the question of accession is Section 6, which effectively says that you need an instrument of accession for a ruler to express his wish to join a particular dominion. This is effectively what happens. So when you speak of the instrument of accession entered into by Raja Hari Singh on the 26th of October 1947 with India, it has to be traceable to some instrument. Can a legal instrument have validity without a backdrop? What is the backdrop? The backdrop is the Independence Act, Indian Independence Act of 1947. Okay, now let's just break this a bit. So between 1842 to 1900s, it's largely a question of a tussle between the paramount power and the state with respect to how the state must be administered. As you move closer to the 1930s, the influence of the Indian independence movement starts spilling over into this particular state, as a consequence of which the question of Pakistan or India becomes relevant. Slowly you're moving in that particular direction. By the time you reach 1946, Pakistan has become a reality that you cannot escape. Between 1946, so what happens? You have a constituent assembly. Therefore, people are elected for the purposes of drafting of the constitution. That's how the constituent assembly was created. Now here comes the important data. 15th of August 1947, this great country is reborn. Constitutionally, of course, it always existed, but it is reborn, so to speak, in a constitutional sense. Between 15th of August 1947 and October 1947, now it gets really, really interesting. What happens is, the princely state of Kashmir and Maharaja Hari Singh has not made up his mind as to which way he wants to go, because he's still weighing the pros and cons. So the pros and cons which effectively weigh on a princely state or the head of the princely state is protection of largely his privileges. Let's be very blunt and honest on that particular front. Which particular state or which country, if I were to join, can I retain the most of my power and privilege? There is a decent chance that the welfare of the people certainly matter, but I'm not sure it comes at the top of the priority list. Okay? So they start, or rather he starts thinking on these lines. So what does he say? pending a decision that I take with respect to the future of this princely state, I want both these countries to be at an arm's length distance from me, and therefore I will enter into what are known as standstill agreements. So the princely state of Kashmir enters into a standstill agreement with Pakistan, whereas India does not enter into a standstill agreement with this particular entity because it says you have not sent people who can sign on your behalf, these are not accredited representatives. Whether that was a mischievous statement or whatever it may be, we refuse to sign a standstill agreement. That was effectively our position. Now, prior to all of this, there is a fantastic dynamic that is developing between the Indian National Congress and the National Conference. Before all of this, because Nehru wants the people of Kashmir to aspire to be part of the Indian Union and not as part of an independent princely state. And it was the position of the Indian National Congress that the independence movement was not being fought against the British only with respect to people of the provinces, but also on behalf of the people of the princely states. So what happens? So in today's parlance, these activists start creating trouble inside, and they support all those voices which want to overthrow the monarchy. So the National Conference gets heavy duty support. Remember, this is all in 1940s, and in 1953, the same Nehru government threw Abdullah behind bars. But look at the love-hate relationship until then. So they want Kashmir to be a part of the Indian Union and to be a part of the constitution-making process. Therefore, they keep talking to the people. Democracy, civil rights, fundamental rights, equality of women. That was the discussion, but of course, under Article 35, there's no equality of women. I'll come to that later. But these were all the buzzwords that were used. As a consequence of which, the following forces have arrayed against Maharaja Hari Singh, but for different reasons. Indian National Congress and National Conference are almost in the same tent. Where they disagree is what shall be the future degree of autonomy that is given to the princely state of Kashmir after it is acceded. Muslim Conference is very clear. Sorry, I'm going green. They're very clear about it. Okay? And Maharaja Hari Singh says, both of you are creating trouble. Because that creates trouble with respect to his power and pelf and privilege as the head of a princely state. Okay. So all this happens. So by the time you reach the stage of 1947, India says nothing doing. I'm not entering into a standstill agreement with you. In fact, all the treaties that the princely state of Kashmir has entered into with the British, we do not recognize. They said this. That was the position. And the good part is National Conference was echoing the same sentiment. So clearly there was some handshake between the two parties. Both of them said, these are outdated treaties which were entered into without the consent of the people, as a consequence of which we do not see the relevance of any of these treaties at this point of time. Therefore, the very document that created the 1846 princely state of Kashmir was challenged. They said, we refuse to recognize this, and in none of our discussions with the British, will we ever try and protect the interests of the princely states? We represent only the common people of India, including the provinces and the princely states. Now, obviously, when the discussion is going on with the paramount power, one says, I have given you army, I have given you money, protect my interest. That is the interest of the princely state. So all these princely states, they decide to form what is called as the Chamber of States. Okay? And they have their own representatives who are talking to the British government to protect their interests while a discussion is going on between the rest of India and the British. So two things happen at this point of time. I'm just giving you a few things, you can then look them up. So one is the cabinet mission of May 1946, which effectively wanted to start discussions with various parties on the constitution. Then is of course the mission of Sir Stafford Cripps, where he decided to identify what would go with Pakistan, what would go with India, how would the future states look like. These discussions were going on. Now, by the time you reach the stage of the standstill agreement, Pakistan says, look, you take my word. I am effectively taking an oath on the holy book. I will not violate your modesty as long as you don't choose to come with us. So I will respect the standstill agreement. And most importantly, even if you choose not to be with us, we don't have a problem, just don't go with India. That is the position of Pakistan. This is something that they enter into, and by the time we reach October 1947, they have amassed all the Afridi Lashkars from the Northwest Frontier Province, along with regular soldiers of the Pakistan Army, and they start violating the modesty of Kashmir. Let's put it that way. And they enter the place. They just swarm into that place. And they've almost reached, they take over the Gilgit Agency, the Baltistan Agency, they've taken over Muzaffarabad. And important part is, their entire premise is that we as a Muslim state will protect the interest of Muslims and we want you to join us. And they kept raping Muslim women until Srinagar. Of course, Hindus and Sikhs were targeted. That's a different issue. That's always there. That's a different issue because these were refugees who had come from West Punjab and they entered the place. So that happened. But they didn't spare anyone. They're very, very egalitarian in that particular sense. They're absolutely equal. In fact, most of the theaters and cinema halls of Kashmir had become dens of gang rapes. This was effectively the position. Okay? They did not see whether it was a male, female, age, nothing mattered. They just went about their jobs. Okay? This is what happened. Now, the troops of the Kashmir state were not enough, so they were sent to different parts of the front, or let's say of the front, so to speak, to try and defend. But they couldn't do anything about it. That's when he sends out an SOS to India. Come save me, protect my izzat. Okay? So then an SOS goes out, and India still says, you ask me for help, until then I will come. Okay? The problem is perhaps India was being unnecessarily dignified and decent at that point of time, is my position, because even if ultimately you wanted the state to take a voluntary decision with respect to accession, that object was being defeated by somebody's invasion. Therefore, your primary duty ought to have been to rush to the defense of a potential state to say that I want to maintain the status quo until the status quo sways one way or the other or swings one way or the other. There is no question of either of us trying to tilt the balance. That is the position that India ought to have taken. But by the time India took a decision, one third of Kashmir was lost. So anybody who wants to say that we won the 1948 war, I must ask them, what do you mean by victory? Retaining two thirds or having lost one third? That's a question that you should ask yourself. Okay? This is an honest discussion that I think is warranted because effectively one third is gone. Okay? And that one third, we still don't know when we'll get back. Not just that, to put it in the terms of civil law, he has created a further interest in it by having given some portion of it to China under an agreement of March 1963. Okay? I'll come to that later and I'll tell you the terms of this agreement. It makes for astounding reading. It makes for absolutely astounding reading. So while the standstill agreement is there and this happens, then the SOS is sent. Then of course, Mountbatten of Burma, a distant relative of Nehru, he steps in. Okay? He decides to get into the picture. Okay? So he decides to get into the picture and then he says, okay, so Maharaja sends a letter along with an instrument of accession. And he says, I agree with your instrument of accession. And once, let's say, peace has been restored in this particular place, we will then decide what shall be the decision of the people with respect to who they want to go with. That was still the position as far as Mountbatten is concerned. Now, this was Mountbatten's position, whereas Nehru's position, if you see from the Constituent Assembly debates of May and November and October 1949, along with Mr. Gopalswamy Iyengar, was that the accession was absolute. People who quote Nehru to support secession of Kashmir must read what was Nehru's position in the Constituent Assembly debates. He said that the instrument of accession is absolute. And any question of a plebiscite is only after satisfaction of the plebiscite conditions under the United Nations Security Council plebiscite. I'll come to that. So the position is this accession agreement, Mountbatten believes is conditional, whereas Nehru believes that it is absolute. This is his position. In fact, when Professor K.T. Shah and another gentleman, I think H.V. Kamath, were taking the position that the instrument of accession is conditional, Nehru gets up to say this is astoundingly dumb and stupid. He says, I'm amazed by their position that this is a conditional accession. It is an absolute accession. This is Nehru, the fount of all that is good with India, who says this. Okay? Point number three. So once this instrument of accession is entered into, then something happens. What happens? Instrument of accession is entered into on the 26th of November, 1947. The Constituent Assembly was constituted in 1946. So there are already discussions going on with respect to a future constitution for India. And Kashmir accedes to India in October 1947. But the instrument of accession says, with effect from 15th of August 1947. That's what they say. So people from all over the country are part of the Constituent Assembly debates towards the crafting of the constitution, but there is no representation from Kashmir. So to address this, subsequently they say, we will have four people from Kashmir who shall be part of the discussions in the crafting and drafting of this particular document, because that we believe is going to apply even to that particular state. Now, who chooses these four people? Now, what you have to realize is, once this invasion happens, this violation of modesty happens, the Maharaja says, I don't think I'm doing a great job. Let's have an emergency administration and let's choose the most popular face today as the Prime Minister of Kashmir. That is how Sheikh Abdullah becomes the head of the emergency administration. And he is given that particular position. Okay? Because he was effectively the face of the Kashmiri aspiration according to the Maharaja at that point of time. So he becomes the head of it. So who will effectively negotiate on behalf of Kashmir with India? Sheikh Abdullah and his entire team. Okay? So these are the people who start negotiating with India with respect to this. When they start discussing this, there are two baskets that you must remember on which the discussions revolved around. The first basket relates to only those subjects which are expressly mentioned in the instrument of accession. The second are those subjects which are not mentioned in the instrument of accession. Why? Could you please just open the instrument, the Article 370, and now I'll show how we proceed from here. Yes. Now this becomes very, very interesting and relevant. It may have come across as a bit boring now, but try and understand what's happening here. Okay. Now, why does it say temporary provisions with respect to the state of Jammu and Kashmir? Why? Because this state was an exception for which a separate constitution was being negotiated. That is why these provisions are temporary. When Kashmir decided to accede to India, one of the fundamental conditions was that we shall have a separate constitution which will effectively decide the scope of issues over which India shall have power, over which Kashmir shall have power, and over which both of us will have power. Therefore, what? Their version of the union list, their version of the state list, and their version of the concurrent list. That was the discussion. How those issues shall be decided and how this so-called, let's call it a partition suit, was actually arrived at. That is effectively the discussion about Article 370. This is very important. Remember that there were constituent assemblies even for the princely state of Travancore, for Mysore and other places. But that was under the condition that the moment India has a constitution, all of these will merge with that supreme book. Whereas this particular state was meant to be an exception. At least that was the understanding. Therefore, just bear with me when I give these timelines. November 1951 is when the Constituent Assembly of Kashmir comes into being, of Kashmir. And the Constitution of Kashmir was brought into force in September 1956. When did our constitution come into force? When was the drafting completed? 26th of November 1949, it comes into force on the 26th of January 1950. Kashmir's Constituent Assembly comes into being when? November 1951. And the constitution comes into force when? September 1956. Article 370 was meant to preserve the relationship between the state and the union until September 1956. That's what I'm coming to. So 238 as a provision is effectively about part A and part B, where you have classification of states, which is a princely state and all that. I'll come to that, but it's been repealed, of course, now. So what do you understand of temporary provisions? I have not even got into the language so far. I'm only on the title. Why is it temporary? It is not temporary primarily because of Article 370 that the president can remove it. It is primarily temporary because it was meant to be a stopgap measure until a constitution for that particular state was framed. This is the position. So what happens now? The instrument of accession covers three specific subject matters: foreign affairs, communications, and defense. Therefore, with respect to these three subjects which fall under basket A, India would have the last word. Okay? But with respect to other subjects, you either need the concurrence of the state government or you need to have consultation with the state government, and in some cases you needed the recommendation of the Constituent Assembly. Okay, these were multiple stages. Okay, now I'll explain how this works. First, and this is going to be a bit of legal interpretation, but you'll enjoy this if you enjoy logic and reasoning. So just wait with me, just bear with me, okay? When a provision starts with notwithstanding anything in this constitution, that means no matter what anything else, any other provision of the constitution says, what is written pursuant to or below this particular clause shall effectively hold the field, to put it in, let's say, a lawyer's terms. This will effectively be the position. That will, so therefore, Article 370 is a law in itself. It has its own position. There are other provisions of the constitution which have special provisions for Northeast as well, Assam and Nagaland. Therefore, to say that only Kashmir was given a special status, no. We have given special treatments to other states, but the subject matter is different. What forms the subject matter of the special treatment of Kashmir is the central question. Okay? Now, hold on for a moment here. So once the Constitution of Kashmir comes into being in 1956, if there is a provision of that particular constitution which says that we are an avibhajya bhag of India, which is an integral part of India, effectively, that state's constitution itself has acceded absolutely and finally, notwithstanding what happens to Article 370, because this was meant to be a temporary provision until the framing of the constitution. If your state's constitution effectively says that I shall be an integral part of India, that is the end of the matter. This is from the Constitution of Kashmir, the state, relationship of the state. The state of Jammu and Kashmir is and shall be integral part of the Union of India. So the fear that removal of Article 370 could lead to renewed questions of secession, according to me, are fundamentally ignorant. Because perhaps people have read only Article 370, but not the Constitution of Jammu and Kashmir. Which is why I said you cannot understand Article 370 by reading that alone. So there was a famous colonial statement, you cannot understand England without understanding the rest of the world. So you can't understand Article 370 without understanding the rest of the history of the provision. Okay. So this is what it says. Now I'll go back. I keep doing this over and above so that your thinking is a bit non-linear as far as this is concerned, because the sequence of events is certainly not linear. Okay, at least the developments are not linear. Now, just take a look at subclause A. The provisions of Article 238 shall not apply in relation to the state of Jammu and Kashmir. That is with respect to Part A and Part B states. Now, for a moment, just take a look at list of states. Jammu and Kashmir is a part of the first schedule of the constitution where you have listed which are the territories which fall under the Union of India. Therefore, I'm giving you a second peg. The Constitution of India, Constitution of Kashmir says that state is an integral part of India, and there is a handshake between that provision and the first schedule of the Indian Constitution, which says that it is a part of India. And when you define Jammu and Kashmir, remember, whatever may be the de facto position today, the de jure position is that POK, let's say, belongs to us, and the portion given to China belongs to us. So when we speak of Jammu and Kashmir, we refer to the entire state, not, to use Jinnah's word, the moth-eaten, truncated portion that we are in control of today. Okay? So this is the position. Now, I'll go back again. This is like watching Matrix, so just bear with me. I keep going up and down. I'm not Neo. I don't know if I'm the one. So notwithstanding anything in this constitution, the provisions of Article 238, forget Article 238 for a moment. Now focus only on Clause B. Okay? I'm putting out my bag of tricks as a lawyer. Okay? And without any payment. So my payment is your attention. The power of Parliament. So whose power does it refer to? Parliament. To make laws for the said state. Okay? The power of the Parliament to make laws for the said state shall be limited to what? To those matters in the Union list and the concurrent list. If I may just use this for a moment, because I have to go closer to the provision. I have no other option. Can I? Yes, am I audible?
Yes,
okay. Facebook must be missing me. Yeah.
Okay. Those matters in the union list and the concurrent list, in consultation with the government of the state. So here you don't need concurrence, you need what? Only consultation. I don't need your sammati. I only need to talk to you. And regardless of your sammati, I go ahead. Consultation with the government of state are declared by the president to correspond to those matters specified in what? Instrument of accession. Which means, on those subjects which fall under the union list and the concurrent list, which correspond to the three subjects specified in the instrument of accession, namely what? Defense, communication, and external affairs. The president does not need, or the parliament does not need the concurrence, but it only needs consultation. And therefore, the power of the parliament with respect to these issues is supreme. Now, when I have power over your communication, over your defense and external affairs, are you not a part of India? Are you not a part of India? Yes. Of course you're a part of India. The only question is, are we sleeping on two different beds or the same bed? That is the only question. That is a question of autonomy. That is a question of autonomy. I'm assuming that everybody is over 18, so bear with the language. Okay. So therefore, the point is, once I'm responsible for defense, communication, and external affairs, I answer on your behalf to a third party. A father and son may fight within the house, but if the father answers on behalf of the family to outsiders, bab bab hai, beta beta hai. Clear? Okay. Next. Such other matters in the said lists. Which lists? Obviously, it is referring to a list referred to before, which is what? The union list and the concurrent list. We have not touched on the state list yet. Such other matters in the said lists as with the concurrence of, now the concurrence word comes in, with the concurrence of the government of the state, the president may by order specify. So now here's the thing. This is the provision which gives the president the power to issue orders with respect to those provisions of the constitution which are other matters, such other matters in the said list, which means what? Union list and concurrent list, assume for a moment it is put together a universe, universe A. That universe A, when it has matters which are specified in the instrument of accession, those three matters, for those things I don't need your concurrence. But other than those three issues, for other issues mentioned in the two lists, I need what? Your concurrence. But it says what? Concurrence of who? The government of the state. The government of the state is effectively today a handshake with previously the Sadar e Riyasat, which is the governor. So the president needs concurrence of the governor of Jammu and Kashmir and not the elected member, because the government of the state, now take a look at this explanation. For the purposes of this article, the government of the state means the person for the time being recognized by the president as the Maharaja of Jammu and Kashmir. The Maharaja of Jammu and Kashmir was replaced by the Sadr e Riyasat, the governor, according to their own constitution. And subsequently, Sadr e Riyasat was converted to a reference to the governor in 1954. Therefore, when you speak of the government of the state, who are you referring to? Governor, not Huriyat, not anybody else. This is what you need when you're, I'm pegging it at the highest, which is to say, even where I need concurrence of who? The governor. Okay. Everybody jumping up and down that Kashmir will go up in flames should actually read this. Okay. Now I'll go to the next portion. Now it gets even more interesting. So this is the power of the parliament with respect to only two lists. Okay. Now, next. Now read C. The provisions of Article 1 and this article shall apply in relation to that state. What is Article 1? It defines India. Bharat. India, which is Bharat. So the provisions of Article 1, they apply to Jammu and Kashmir. That means Jammu and Kashmir is an avibhajya bhag of Bharat. I've given you three pegs. I've given you three pegs. The constitution of Jammu and Kashmir, the first schedule to the Constitution and Article 370. I'm using Article 370 against those who say Article 370 will effectively kill this relationship. Okay? Next. Such of the other provisions of this Constitution shall apply. Now, just bear with me for a moment. So, such of the other provisions of this Constitution shall apply in relation to that state, subject to exceptions and modifications as the president may by order specify. Now, the previous provision referred to only subject under concurrent list or union list. It did not refer to other provisions of the Constitution. It was referring to the lists. This provision is with respect to other provisions of the Constitution, which means other than Article 1 and 370, if you want to apply any other provision of the Constitution of the state of to the state of Jammu and Kashmir, it is by way of what? The president's order, which is why you needed Article 368 to be applied through a president's order. Please note, and now I'll come to the issue, Article 35A was introduced using this power in 1954. Now here, just hold on. You may not know the law, but I'm sure all of you are possessed with common sense and logic. So hold on for a moment. That may be a rebuttable presumption, but I'm effectively treating that as granted. Now, such are the provisions of this Constitution, correct? That means other provisions of the Constitution shall be applied through presidential order. Does it give the president to insert a new provision? It says what? Such are the provisions shall apply in relation to the state subject to such exceptions or modifications. That means the president has the power to apply other provisions of the Constitution as is veris, or he can make changes and apply to the state. Does it give him the power to create a new provision for the state? That is the language. Why? When you create a new provision for the state through the Constitution, what are you doing? You're amending the Constitution. When you're amending the Constitution, Article 368 comes into being. Who can amend the Constitution? Logic. Only the elected representatives. Which means who? Parliament. And this is what the power of the president. A five-judge bench in 1961. Puranlal, Lakhanlal versus something, effectively said that the power of the president to make exceptions and modifications to other existing provisions also means inserting a new provision. This was the logic of the Supreme Court, a five-judge bench, a constitution bench. I think we have to revisit the concept of a constitution bench. Anyways, the point I'm trying to make is this. Use common sense. When you say such other provisions of the Constitution, that means that provision must already exist in the Constitution when you apply that particular power. Does it give you the power to conjure a provision out of thin air? It does not. That is the central debate about Article 35A. Whether the procedure under Article 368 with respect to amendment of a constitution, of the Constitution, was followed by the president when in 1954, through the presidential order of application of the Constitution to the state of Jammu and Kashmir, it was open to him to introduce a new provision. That is the question. We are saying, if he can give, he can also take. That's the argument. Now, this proviso becomes important. Provided that no such order which relates to the matter specified in the instrument of accession, that means, when the president chooses to invoke his power under this clause for the purposes of touching on those matters in the accession of the state, you again go back to consultation. You need the consultation with who? The state government. And when you're going outside the state instrument of accession, again you need what? Concurrence. That is the difference. So one provision refers to the power of the parliament, the other provision refers to the power of the president. And with respect to the issues which are covered by the instrument of accession, whether it is the parliament or the president, they only need to consult. And for issues outside of that, they need concurrence. That's the basic difference. Now, let's come to something very, very important. 2 and 3, according to me, are where, I think that's where the tail hangs. Because there is no reference to Constituent Assembly here. There is no reference to the State Assembly anywhere until you reach 372. Because you're only referring to who are the dramatis personae, the parliament, the president, and the government of the state. That's it. Nobody else? Right? Now take a look at this. If the concurrence of the government of the state referred to in paragraph 2 of clause B and so on and so forth, of that clause B given before the Constituent Assembly for the purpose of framing the Constitution, it shall be placed before the Assembly. What are they saying? I'll explain. If you go outside the subjects which are mentioned in the instrument of accession, but which fall within clause D, which is under this, or under clause B, that means before the Constituent Assembly is even created, you are giving more power to the Union on subject matters other than defense, communication, and external affairs. Therefore, when you give such an important power to the Union, you need to take the permission of the Assembly, the Constituent Assembly, is that statement. Now, Constitution of Kashmir has come. Can there be a Constituent Assembly at this point of time? Ho gaya na. Horses have bolted from the stables, right? It's gone, right? That means, as far as this is concerned, what it means is, if on these subjects, if the Constituent Assembly did not give the Union the power, then everything else will be guided only by 371. You can't go back to this. Now I'll come to 373. Okay. Notwithstanding anything in the foregoing provisions of this article, which means 371 and 372, both. Okay. Now you have to understand, 371 says notwithstanding anything contained in the Constitution. This says notwithstanding anything contained in the foregoing provisions. That means by default, regardless of what happens anywhere in the rest of the Constitution, this is the current position. What does it say? The President may, by what? Public notification, declare that this article, that is the entire article 370, shall cease to be operative or shall be operative only with exceptions and modifications from such date as he may specify, provided that the recommendation of the Constituent Assembly of the state referred to in clause 2 shall be necessary. That means, if the President wants to render Article 370 inoperative completely, he can do so through a public notification. That's point number one, conclusion one. The second conclusion is, so he can either remove entire 370 or with such modifications and exceptions. Second, provided that the recommendation of the Constituent Assembly of the state shall be necessary before he issues this notification. Previously you saw concurrence, consultation. What is the word used now? Recommendation. Now, if you're a lawyer, you can quibble over the difference between concurrence and recommendation. But let's read this together. So there are two arguments on this particular provision. One camp says, if there is no Constituent Assembly, the proviso alone is infructuous. That means it is dead because there is no Constituent Assembly today. That means without the proviso, today only this provision exists, which effectively means that the President can come out with a notification to abrogate and repeal Article 370. That is one school of thought. The other school of thought says, sorry, you have misunderstood the consequence and the context of this particular provision. The power to remove 370 was available only as long as the Constituent Assembly existed. And it was in a position to recommend. Once the Constituent Assembly is dissolved, its job is done, and the Constitution has come into being, there is no recommendation that can go from the Constituent Assembly to the President. Therefore, 373 cannot be used, is the consequence. Which is to say, if you read this entire provision without history, you will simply say, proviso to gaya, effectively 373 is gone. But if you read it along with the entire history, that means for abrogation of Article 370, the recommendation of the Constituent Assembly was necessary. It is a condition precedent. So if, let's say, there is no Constituent Assembly today, how do you remove Article 370? That is the question. Now I'll answer that question. According to me, this entire argument is, you should be focusing on this and you're focusing on something else. Why? This is temporary. Why? What was supposed to come into force? The Constitution of Jammu and Kashmir. Constitution of Jammu and Kashmir has come into force. 370 has done its job. Therefore, 370 has become useless. My point is, the object of creating 370 is over. That is the big picture. Because that was meant for the framing of the Constitution of Kashmir. It is a transitional period. That's why I'm saying it's a temporary and transitional provision. Which means that the moment a constitution for Jammu and Kashmir has come into existence, Article 370 has done its job. That means it was meant to be, now I'll go to the title of my topic, a bridge until the twain meets. The twain has met. Thanks to the constitution of Jammu and Kashmir. Now you can't create a barricade using it. Okay? Your constitution has accepted it. Now, they will say, okay, it is my constitution that says that you and I are married. What if my constitution says that we will no more be a part of it? Not possible. Because you're bound by the instrument of accession, which is still a legal document. You're bound by Article 1, and you're bound by the first schedule. Therefore, all you can do is decide, as I said, how far the beds will be. In terms of autonomy, that is a question of granting autonomy, but not a question of secession. The question of secession went out of the window on the September 17th, 1956, when the Constitution of Jammu and Kashmir came into existence. That is the end of the matter as far as secession is concerned. But secession is a red herring. That is not what you should be focusing on. The real problem is in Article 35A. Yeah. Why? What does Article 35A do? Now I'll show Article 35A. Now, just to summarize before I go any further. The argument with respect to Article 373 should not be had in the absence of reference to the history and the context. And the context was that it will be a temporary bridge. And once the purpose of the bridge is served, what does that also mean? That the State Assembly of Jammu and Kashmir has taken the view that it shall be with India. So also there is no question of a plebiscite or a referendum. Understand that. When Pakistan asks that question, or friends of Pakistan from India ask that question, the answer is, the moment the Constitution of Jammu and Kashmir has taken this categorical position, the people of Jammu and Kashmir have taken a position, it is their voice that is represented in the Constitution of Jammu and Kashmir. So there cannot be a question of succession at all. Let's be clear about that. Okay? Now, in fact, I'll come to the plebiscite subsequently and you'll see how interesting it is and how much we argue in ignorance by reading stuff selectively. He's saying you could not have promulgated Article 35A through a presidential exercise of power, and it was possible only through the power of the parliament to amend itself. Clear. Now, here's the important point. Correct. Now, I'll connect it with, everybody is very popular with this basic structure doctrine of Keshavananda Bharati. Right. This Article 35A comes into force on the 14th of May, 1954. The cutoff date under Keshavananda Bharati. So what does Keshavananda Bharati say? There is a basic structure which the founding fathers, I don't understand why they ever use the word mothers. We are supposed to be an egalitarian country. We are looking at social justice and all that. No, I thought they should have actually said founding fathers and mothers, or founding parents at the very least. Anyways. So the founding fathers apparently had a certain basic structure in mind which no brute majority can take away by exercise of Article 368. That is the argument that is given. That means every legislation must be tested on the anvils of Article 368, in particular for violation of Part 3, where you have fundamental rights. But they said something else. This logic shall apply to those legislations which come after a cutoff date that we have decided, which is the cutoff date of the judgment, 23rd of April 1973. So they say, we will apply this logic only to prospective legislations, that is after 1973. Otherwise, if basic structure doctrine were to be applied to Article 35A, this will fall and there will be nothing left of its foundation. Primarily, even without getting into the merits, because Article 368, the procedure has not been followed. The president has no power under Article 368. Therefore, a good case exists for reference of the 1961 judgment where the validity of Article 35A was upheld to a larger bench. At the very least, you need 7 to 9 people to sit and ask themselves this question. We have allowed this abomination to continue. Now I'll come to the merits of the issue. Notwithstanding anything contained in this constitution, okay, again, notwithstanding anything contained in this constitution, no existing law in force in the state of Jammu and Kashmir and no law thereafter enacted by the legislature of the state defining the classes of persons who are or shall be permanent residents. Therefore, that portion of the constitution which deals with citizenship does not apply
insofar as Kashmir is concerned, because they can decide who can and cannot be the citizens and permanent citizens and residents of that particular state. Now, remember this, citizenship is from Articles 5 to 11. This is under Part 2 of the Constitution. Just hold on for a moment. Just hold that thought. Please do remember this, okay? And they can confer on such permanent residents any special rights and privileges, which also means you can exclude people from the vestation of rights and privileges depending on how you define. Do you know that Rohingyas have been given permanent resident cards? So Rohingyas have been given permanent resident cards when the Indian government is basically saying they need to be deported on security issues. The state of Jammu and Kashmir has already given permanent resident cards to Rohingyas. That is the extent of autonomy that has been granted to that particular state. So kindly move away from the question of succession. That is over, that is settled. What remains is the question of autonomy. What remains is the question of internal democracy. What remains is whether this has an impact on the demographics of the place. In 1947, what was the population of Kashmir? 4 million, 40 lakh. What was the population of Muslims and non-Muslims? 74% and 26%. What is the current population? It has dwindled. In one fell swoop, on the 18th of January 1990, I think if I get the date right, 5 lakhs are out. So you cannot decide anything with respect to Kashmir without calling back all those people. Because they have a right with respect to the future and the destiny of that particular state. You're talking of a situation as it existed in 1947. Please recreate that situation, then we'll talk. Which means the state must become conducive for every community to settle and rehabilitate and to enjoy all rights and privileges which are available to everybody else in the rest of India. This is one argument. Now, it can decide what? Permanent residence, then grant of special rights and privileges, employment under the state government, which is representation in state government today is the subject of reservation in several judgments of the Supreme Court, and it is the legislature, in fact, they have the power to decide who will be employed in the state government of Kashmir. Can you call yourself a citizen of a particular state or a country without being represented in its administration? Is there any participation? No. That is precisely why you look for reservations when they don't get adequate representation, right? What about this state? What about this state? Now, I'll come to it next. Acquisition of immovable property. You can't buy immovable property in the state unless and until you're a permanent resident. And who is a permanent resident shall be decided by the state government. Next. Settlement in the state. Whether you want to make Kashmir your home or not. Illegal migrants can get permanent resident cards, but the rest of India cannot decide whether they want to buy property or whether they'll be represented in employment or whether they'll get any privileges or whether they'll settle in that particular state. That is Indian, I don't know, secularism? That's the word, yes. Yes. Then, right to scholarships. I know, you asked me not to get political. I'm not being political. I'm merely being logical. Yes. Right to scholarships and other such forms. So if you're a poor person, or you're an SC, or an ST, or an OBC, you will be entitled to all rights and privileges in the rest of India, except... So it was called the Happy Valley, except the Happy Valley. Okay. Now, shall be void on the ground that it is inconsistent with or takes away... Now, just please focus here. Shall be void on the ground that it is inconsistent with... or takes away or abridges any rights conferred on other citizens of India by any provision of this part. That means you cannot strike down any legislation that is promulgated as a consequence of Article 35A on the ground that it violates this part. What is this part? Part 3. That means you can challenge every other legislation on grounds of violation of Part 3 or fundamental rights. But a law which is made under Article 35A is immune from the challenge. So there goes your basic structure out of the window second time. Therefore, even the judiciary cannot test any legislation under Article 35A for violation of Part 3. Now, what did I say citizenship comes under? Part 2. So this can be struck down on grounds of violation of Part 2? Article 35A and laws made under Article 35A are immune from challenge on grounds of violation of this part, not this constitution, which means it can be shielded only with respect to fundamental rights. But if it can be challenged on grounds of violation of citizenship, that comes under what? Part 2, Articles 5 to 11. Therefore, Article 35A... Equivalent to emergency period. That's what I'm saying. My point is...
Secondly, Article 368 comes under Part 20 of the Constitution. Therefore, I can't challenge 35A on grounds of violation of Part 3, but I can certainly challenge it for violation of Part 20 and Part 2. Therefore, anybody who says that Article 35A is something that is written in stone has not read the language of the provision. So what are the layers at which you can challenge Article 35A? The President had no business, I'm sorry to say this, His Excellency did not have the power to violate or to circumvent Article 368 and by introducing a new provision. Because that means, for that particular purpose, India is effectively ruled by a dictator where the Parliament has no say. Because the Parliament has not allowed that particular amendment. It was not tabled before the Parliament. Second, it is violative of Part 2 with respect to citizenship, which is very important. It violates Part 20 because of Article 368.
Who
right?
Was the Prime Minister and President at that time?
Sir, this was 1954.
35A.
That's what came out in 1954. Sri Rajendra Prasad and Nehru, of course. Nehru. Everything, Nehru. India has to be grateful to. So the point I'm trying to make is 370. I'm not making a case for abrogation of, I'm not saying that you can't touch 370. I'm saying even if you touch, you will achieve nothing. Because 370 is a dead snake. The moment the Constitution of Jammu and Kashmir has come into existence, 370 has lost all its value. I can get into several judgments, but this is the broad point. I don't wish to bore you with further legalese, but please understand the broad picture. I am trying to break down legal interpretation for an audience which is both legal and non-legal. Second, Article 35A is the bigger problem. We were told the judgment of 18th of September 2018 in Sabarimala that India is all about women empowerment.
Yeah.
A woman of Kashmir, if she marries an outsider, loses her permanent resident certificate. Whether he's a Hindu or a Muslim doesn't make a difference, understand that. Okay. This is the point with respect to Article 35A. So somebody asked me, are you going to discuss Article 35A as part of Article 370? It's clear that you cannot discuss one without discussing the other.
Yes. Yes.
Okay. This is the answer to the question. So can the President do away with Article 35A? According to me, so now let's go to the 1954 constitutional order. I don't think I have it here. Can I take the liberty of reading? Is that okay? Yes, please. From what I remember of this particular provision, I'm sorry, I'm just not able to locate it, but from what I remember of this particular provision, I don't think you'll have the constitution order here. Okay, but I'll just use my poor memory, and I think it says that this particular order was passed with the concurrence of the state assembly, of the government of the state.
Yeah.
Okay, assume for a moment that the president cannot independently abrogate Article 35A, he needs the concurrence of who? The government of the state. The government is who?
Governor.
There's your job. Done. Dusted. I am not oversimplifying it. In fact, I'll give further documents to support my position. Now, among the documents relating to history, the one document that becomes extremely important is the document of 1974, which is the Kashmir Accord, entered into between Srimati Indira Gandhi, or I don't know whether it is Miss or Mrs., but I'll keep it as Miss Gandhi. No, frankly, I don't know, because today you can't say Mrs., it's wrong. So that's why I'm using Miss, I'm not raising any questions. I'm simply saying it was between Miss Gandhi and Sheikh Abdullah. And that particular provision, if I remember it right, in fact, it's an accord which clearly says that the president has the power to repeal any provision of the constitution which was applied with exception or modification to the state of Kashmir. That means also Article 35A and all future provisions of the constitution that shall be applied to the state shall be applied without any alteration. That was the agreement between Sheikh Abdullah and Srimati Gandhi. Now, as students of law, the one question then you will ask is,
what is the legal relevance of a political accord entered into between representatives in the interpretation of a provision. My point is, if effectively Kashmir has seen itself as a special entity, any representation that is made on behalf of that special entity has legal value. Therefore, you cannot dismiss that accord as merely a political accord. I will treat that as a legal document on which there is a signature on behalf of Kashmiris. Therefore, the government has the power to use Article 370 for the purposes of repealing anything that was done before, which includes Article 35A. Okay, because Article 370 was used to introduce Article 35A, I'm saying you can use it to take it back. Okay. I don't wish to go down that contentious path. I'm simply saying that even without that, Article 370 need not be removed citing 373. It can be removed because it is useless. That's it. Now it says, with such modifications and exceptions. So Mr. A.G. Noorani has written, oh, if you remove entire Article 370, you're also removing the reference to say that Article 1 shall apply. Right? Okay, I'll keep that and remove everything else. Because it says you can remove 370 with modifications and exceptions. So I will retain that particular portion that says that Article 1 shall apply to the state of Kashmir, and I'll remove everything else. But the point is this, you can give any amount of arguments. The question is, what is your intention? To keep the issue alive or to settle the issue for good? You want options? There are options, both judicial and legislative and presidential. The question is, what is it that you want? You have to read the amount of money that this government or Indian governments have spent on Kashmir. Most importantly, there's a brilliant document that I would like to read out for the benefit of this audience. Can I just go back to the plebiscite and then I'll come to this, okay? I usually am a hands-free speaker. The reason why I'm actually doing this is because I want to get a few facts right. I don't want anybody to accuse me of going through WhatsApp University. I don't rely on WhatsApp for my information. Because that's a common allegation when somebody makes these points. No, 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 you are not a scholar. You don't have a book. You're not an author. Therefore, why should we take you seriously? Now, I'll read the UN resolution. Okay. Now, the UN resolution makes for fantastic reading. And sorry, just a second. I know I'm just spilling over into my time for question and answers. I don't want to be seen as running away from any questions. Questions are welcome. UN resolution. Yes. I'll just read this portion. This is the United Nations resolution of 13th of August 1948. Sorry. Correct. Of 13th of August 1948. Now, it's a bit long, barely 1.5 pages, just bear with me. The resolution of the United Nations Security Council of 13th of August 1948, to which Pakistan was a party, but observed it only, it only in its breach, reads as follows. The United Nations Commission for India and Pakistan. So the Security Council, the United Nations, set up a commission for India and Pakistan to resolve the Kashmir issue after we decided to internationalize it without any reason. Having given careful, so the aggressor gets in without informing the United Nations, but the defender wants to take the United Nations permission to defend himself. That's great. Having given careful consideration to the points of view expressed by the representatives, being of the opinion, so on and so forth, now, truce agreement, okay? Truce agreement is part two. Simultaneously with the acceptance of the proposal for immediate cessation of hostilities as outlined, both governments accept the following principles as a basis for the formulation of a truce agreement, the details of which shall be worked out in discussion between the representatives and commission. A, as the presence of troops of Pakistan in the territory of the state of Jammu and Kashmir constitutes a material change in the situation, since it was represented by the government of Pakistan before the Security Council, the government of Pakistan agrees to withdraw its troops from the state, which is POK, vacate first and then talk. Next. The government of Pakistan will use its best endeavor to secure the withdrawal from the state of Jammu and Kashmir of tribesmen and Pakistani nationals not normally resident therein who have entered the state for the purpose of fighting. Why is this important? Pakistan over the years has been creating the argument, and that's why the entire activity, that all the rebellion which is coming from POK is indigenous and Pakistan army has got no role to play in it. So they will say, we have withdrawn our formal forces. People who are there are non-state actors. That is the game plan. To prevent and circumvent the withdrawal and to comply with this particular UN security resolution, if you create non-state actors, you will always say, people who are formally associated with me have come out of this place. Now, anybody who's fighting there is indigenously fighting against the occupation of that particular state by the fascist Indian government. That's the argument. Next. Pending a final resolution, the territory evacuated by the Pakistani troops will be administered by the local authorities under the surveillance of the commission. Now, Pakistan has been asked to vacate. What about India? Now you see. When the commission shall have notified the government of India that the tribesmen and Pakistani nationals referred to in part 8 to have hereby withdrawn, thereby terminating the situation which is presented by the government of India to the Security Council as having occasioned the presence of Indian forces, and further that the Pakistani forces are being withdrawn, the government of India agrees to begin to withdraw the bulk of its forces, not all of its forces, the bulk of its forces from that stage in stages to be agreed upon with the commission. Now it gets interesting. Pending the acceptance of the conditions for a final settlement of the situation in the state of Jammu and Kashmir, the Indian government will maintain within these lines existing at the moment the minimum strength of its forces, which in agreement with the commission are considered necessary to assist local authorities. Why? You have already established your malafides by invading the place once, and I cannot allow it further. Therefore, I must at least have the minimum force necessary to repel you, to deter you. Then, the government of India will undertake to ensure that the government of state of Jammu and Kashmir will take all measures within its powers to make it publicly known that peace, law and order will be guaranteed. Next. Upon signature, the full truth, so and so. Now, part 3. Government of India and government of Pakistan reaffirm their wish that the future status of the state of Jammu and Kashmir shall be determined in accordance with the will of the people, and to that end, upon acceptance of the truce agreement, both governments agree to enter into consultations with the commission to determine fair and equitable conditions. That means a plebiscite can be had, if at all possible now, only after withdrawal of the troops of Pakistan. But most importantly, as I said, the 1963 agreement where they ended up ceding territory to China comes in the way of the implementation of the resolution, because you gave away something even before the right over that particular territory could be determined finally by the people of Kashmir. So Pakistan has acted against the interests of the people of Kashmir by giving away a portion of its territory to its all-weather friendship, which is China. Now point number one. Now I'll play a devil's advocate here. Kashmiri Assembly has taken a certain position with respect to being part of India. So according to me, a plebiscite is over. A plebiscite in the form of the Constituent Assembly of Jammu and Kashmir is over. They've decided. So stage one is there can be no plebiscite, at least as far as India's Kashmir is concerned, or where Indian troops are present, because they've taken a position. But most importantly, they've taken a position on behalf of the entire Kashmir, not with respect to only territories which are currently in possession of India and ownership of India. So if that is the case, the question of plebiscite is out. You enter into a contract if the other side is willing to perform its obligations. But having reneged on its obligations, according to me, the contract is off. All bets are off. The plebiscite has no meaning. The security resolution has no meaning. And for it to have any meaning, stage one would be for the United Nations Security Council to force China to give back that area, and then for POK to be freed from Pakistani troops, and then for plebiscite to be held. Do you see that happening? United Nations Security Council taking on China. I've answered my question. Okay. So the point is this. Okay, now I'll read something which is very important, and something that according to me is very important, not just for Kashmir, but for harmony across the country. And this would be the letter written by Indian Muslim intellectuals to the United Nations Security Council, saying that Kashmir must be a part of India. Just a second, please. Yes. Text of memorandum submitted by 14 Muslim leaders of India to Frank P. Graham, United Nations representative, page number 322 of this document. I'll just show this to you. And with that, I'll open the floor for questions. This is a letter that was signed by the following leading lights of the Muslim community at that point of time, Dr. Zakir Hussain, who was the Vice Chancellor of Aligarh University, Sir Sultan Ahmed, Sir Muhammad Ahmed Sayyid Khan, Muhammad Usman, Iqbal Ahmed, the Chief Justice of the Allahabad High Court, former Sheriff of Bombay, Minister Government of Hyderabad, former President of Muslim Majlis. Now I'll read out what they say. It is a remarkable fact that while the Security Council and its various agencies have devoted so much time to study the Kashmir dispute and made various suggestions for its resolutions, none of them has tried to ascertain the views of Indian Muslims, nor the possible effect of any hasty step in Kashmir, however well-intentioned, on the interests and well-being of Indian Muslims. We are convinced that no lasting solution for the problem can be found unless the position of Muslims in Indian society is clearly understood. This is not any political voice, this is an intellectual voice in 1951. So the importance of the resolution of this issue for internal harmony is critical. And this document makes it abundantly clear. If circumstances have changed, it is for us to ask how circumstances have changed and why. But most importantly, no decision with respect to the future of Kashmir can be taken unless and until the demographic balance is restored. And Article 35A comes in the way of the restoration of demographic balance. Sheikh Abdullah, in his opening speech to the Constituent Assembly of Kashmir, asks himself, should I go to Pakistan, should I go to India, or should I be independent? And he says, I cannot go to Pakistan because it is a feudal state and it is still not a democracy in its mind. And most importantly, my minorities, which is 25% of my population, will be genocided and massacred if I were to go to Pakistan. That was the position that he took. And most importantly, he said, I cannot hope to survive independently thanks to what Pakistan has already established between August 1947 and 1948. Three, the reason why I must go to India is because we share cultural bonds, the minority relates to that particular country. Most importantly, there are abundant economic reasons for Kashmir to be a part of India, because for all the handicrafts and the businesses of Kashmir, India presents the largest market. He addressed it at a religious level, at a political level, at a constitutional level, and economic level. Therefore, the point I'm trying to make is it's easy to get fast and loose when it comes to Article 370. There is much more to it, but one thing is clear, whether you call it a simplistic conclusion or whatever, Kashmir is, was, and shall remain an integral part of Bharat. As simple as that. The question is, what is the degree of autonomy are you willing to give, and are you going to compromise communal harmony at the expense of autonomy? Is it not possible to give autonomy without disturbing communal harmony? Can that be not discussed? I think that is the limited issue for discussion between the state of Kashmir and the rest of India. I'm not saying Union of India, because Kashmir is a part of India. Okay? Therefore, according to me, this is the limited question. 370 is a dead snake. It has been rendered otiose. It's been rendered infructuous. Thank you. Questions, please. Yes.
Please allow us to give you a hug.
Okay, sir.
Hello, hello.
In one shot, he will kill all the senior advocates.
Questions are welcome. Please do not refer to any religion or religious segment and the so-called terrorist activities, etc. Please confine to political and legal aspects only.
Hello.
Yes, sir.
I'm a layman as far as the legal things are concerned. The common question that comes to my mind is, when all the states were not given separate constitutional rights, why was it allowed in case of Kashmir? Why did we give them to make a constitution assembly by themselves? If they had come to us, they should have come under our umbrella.
Right.
Why was it given to them?
Right. So the limitation is on the question, but not to my answer. So I think I can answer.
Yeah,
okay, thik. So here's the point, sir. From what I understand, and there I think the fundamental premise for a special relationship is a serious problem. Yes, sir. According to me, and here I think Mr. Jagmohan's book becomes very relevant, wherein he says that by not allowing normalization of Kashmir at par with the rest of the country, and by allowing it to retain what it believes is a certain demographic ratio, India has perhaps played into the hands of people who wish to create another bifurcation, so to speak, and people who will never be happy with the rise of India. There, I think, what they ended up doing was to choose between the greater of the two evils, which is allowing Kashmir to be independent is a mirage. Allowing Kashmir to go to Pakistan is unacceptable. So let us retain Kashmir no matter what the cost. And that bargaining principle or that bargaining approach effectively is the price for which we are paying today, according to me. My point is, perhaps you could have agreed to it at that particular stage when the accession was necessary. But between 1951 and 56, when the Constitution of Kashmir was being drafted, perhaps we could have discussed that, let's call it a special package the way it is being discussed for Telangana, on the condition that there cannot be any condition with respect to retaining the demographic parity. You can never say that it will be 76% M and 24% non-M, because that is an argument that no other state of India can make with respect to whatever the composition. Perhaps there, I think, it is easy for us to comment on what they could have done or should have done. I am simply saying that they were choosing, or they decided to choose between two of those evils. However, subsequently, the state of the government of India, according to me, has not behaved as a confident state with respect to Kashmir. It has always been diffident in its approach, as opposed to saying that this belongs to me, there is no question about it. It's not enough for you to say it, it's important for you to walk that particular talk. You have chosen to specifically pander to certain vested interests by making them the voice of the people. As a consequence of which, you have created a Frankenstein's monster, which is now making you dance to its tunes. Two, when demarcation is limited, and that issue is entirely given to the Constitution of Jammu and Kashmir, it also creates a hurdle for trifurcation of the state of Jammu and Kashmir, which is where the letter of the president of the Buddhist Association of Ladakh becomes very important, because he said, Ladakh has always been historically different and independent of what you know as Kashmir. We were at one point part of Tibet, with whom we share a significant cultural relationship. But we don't wish to be a part of Tibet because we want to be part of the mothership of our faith, which is India. That was Ladakh's position, and that remains Ladakh's position. If at least at that point of time we had said, we will treat Kashmir perhaps separately for a temporary point of time, but Ladakh and Jammu shall not be part of that particular discussion because they are non-Muslim majority areas and they have acceded to India. If you have taken that particular position, the scope of the problem and the territorial scope of the problem would have been limited to perhaps 4 or 5 districts. That's it. Today, the bulk of the attention, the bulk of the economic package goes to one particular area, and everybody else is effectively a supplicant for that particular area, and they do not have independent voices. These are potential solutions that I think they could have worked upon. And most importantly, I think after having captured 90,000 Pakistani soldiers in 1971, you should have used that as a serious bargaining chip to finish the issue once and for all. Because effectively, one entire flank of that particular country was at your mercy. They could not have fought on multiple theaters, and you had the upper hand. You had a few people like the USSR jump into your support along with Israel, which was giving you material. Therefore, that was perhaps the best window available to you to settle that particular issue, because that would have left only one outstanding issue. Aksai Chin, which is with China, and that portion of Kashmir which was ceded by Pakistan to China in 1963. The rest of the portion would have come to you completely. In fact, as part of his speech, Sheikh Abdullah also says, Pakistan cannot be a representative for Kashmir because it has proven its perfidy and its perfidious nature by swallowing the princely state of Kalat, which you know as Balochistan today.
Yes.
And they say that just as they need Balochistan for minerals, they will use us for the same thing. They have no other interest. Because if Pakistan truly represents the interests of Muslim, how do they respond and answer to the rape of Muslim women as part of the invasion in 1948? That's a question that Sheikh Abdullah asked. Okay. Now, I am not saying whether he was truthful in what he said. I'm simply taking his words on face value for a moment because I put a serious caveat here. I am not an expert in Kashmir. There are supremely better at people than me when it comes to this subject. But even based on my limited reading so far, I am asking myself, how did you allow Pakistan to become the voice of Kashmir successively and increasingly over the last 70 years? That is something that we shouldn't have done. Next question, please.
So
I'll let the moderators decide who gets the question.
Yeah. So can you throw some light on the background or the situation in which the president promulgated Article 35A? Why did he do that?
Yes. So there was a 1952 agreement, which is called the Delhi Agreement, that was entered into between the representatives of the union and the representatives of the state. Now, the people who were representing the state and the delegation was led by Sheikh Abdullah were extremely hawkish in the sense that unless and until you accede to these particular demands, where an enlarged autonomy is given to this particular state, even with respect to who can be permanent state subjects, the deal is off. And the fear was that they could incite the rest of the state against India. Now, here's the funny part. Look at the timelines. 1948, you have entered into a plebiscite agreement, a truce agreement under the United Nations. Therefore, you do not want a situation where a local voice threatens to incite people against you as and when there is a plebiscite. Which is why the internationalization of the particular issue is something that India should not have done. When you have aspirations of being a statesman, do it at your expense and not at the country's expense. That is the simple message. Because you want to become the leader of the non-alignment movement or because you want to project yourself as the potential recipient of a Nobel Peace Prize, if you decide to stake India's interests without actually being hawkish about it, then you have bequeathed to the rest of the country a problem, perhaps for eternity. Yes. Yes, sir.
Yes. Good evening. I am playing
Can
devil's advocacy.
Can you address this issue because I think it will affect the video.
I am playing the devil's advocacy.
Yes, sir.
See, according to you, without Article 370, the Constitution of Kashmir would not have come into effect.
Correct, sir.
And without Article 370, no, I'll just come to that.
Yeah, please.
Jammu and Kashmir cannot be united with India because Article 1 will not apply without 370, number one. This Article 35A was introduced in Part 3.
Correct.
During 1954.
Yes.
That is prior to the Constitution of Jammu and Kashmir coming into effect.
Correct.
And therefore, it became part of Part 3 and basic structure of the Constitution in so far as Jammu and Kashmir is concerned. How will you overcome that?
Right, okay. As far as 35A is concerned, even if that particular provision came into existence before 1956, the fundamental problem of its legality on the annals of Article 368 continue. Because 368 existed in 1954, it existed in 1956, and it has existed even after that. The procedure with respect to Article 368 has not been changed insofar as the state of Jammu and Kashmir is concerned. Assume for a moment that the provision for amendment of the Constitution had been given a separate status with respect to the state of Jammu and Kashmir, then perhaps it is available for us to argue that no matter when the 35A was introduced in the Constitution, it remains independent of the fetters of Article 368. However, Article 368 with respect to the procedure to be followed for amendment has remained, it has always stayed the same way. So the problem is when the Supreme Court chose to ask itself this question, it focused only on one aspect. Modification and exception would also mean enlargement and introduction. That is the only issue, according to me, which the Supreme Court on that particular point or in that particular case went completely wrong. For me, when 35A was introduced is irrelevant as long as Article 368 stands as it was at the time of the promulgation in 1950. The only change made to Article 368 also came out in 1954 as part of the same constitutional order. What does it say? That provided when you amend the constitution under Article 368, as far as the state of Jammu and Kashmir is concerned, you shall do it in accordance with Article 370. That is how you decided to hitch the wagon of 370 with 368. But there was no amendment made with respect to the procedure followed for the purposes of constitutional amendment. So while they amended the scope of amendment possible under 368 for Jammu and Kashmir, the procedure to be followed for amendment remained unchanged, which means the president under no circumstances was given power from 1950 till 2019 through an amendment to Article 368, giving him the power to introduce a new provision, especially for Kashmir. That's the answer.
The question is, president would have exercised his power,
yes,
under Article 370 itself.
Fair enough.
Because it is in consonance with Article 370.
I'm with you, sir. I'll answer that point. That's why I said Article 370, that's exactly what I answered, saying the power of the president under Article 370 insofar as other provisions of the constitution was to introduce the other provisions of the constitution as is where is or make changes to existing provisions, but not to introduce a new provision. That is where Article 370 has a problem. So assume for a moment that 368 is removed altogether from the equation. Let's assume I have to make an argument only under Article 370. Under Article 370, he could have applied other provisions of the constitution or make changes to other provisions of the constitution. That does not translate to having powers under 368 or having a pseudo power under 368 through 370. That's where the problem is, which is why I showed the language where it says such other provisions of the constitution. That is what 371C specifically refers to, or rather D refers to. When it says such other provisions of the constitution, which means remove Article 1 and remove Article 378, all other provisions you can apply through a presidential order, or you can make changes to those provisions and introduce. Where is the power to introduce a new provision through Article 370?
Okay, done. Let us assume a situation.
Please.
That provision was not introduced in 1954.
Yes, sir.
Then, in the constitution of Jammu and Kashmir itself,
right,
they could have introduced a provision,
right,
wherein it says,
right,
in so far as Jammu and Kashmir is concerned,
correct,
Part 3 is not applicable.
Okay. Now, if they say in their constitution that Part 3 was not applicable, assume for a moment that the Constituent Assembly had taken that particular decision, the problem there would be that as part of the Constituent Assembly, every and any decision taken by the Constituent Assembly has no say as far as India is concerned. Okay? If the Constituent Assembly had taken that particular decision, frankly speaking, I don't think you have a recourse. I don't think you'd have had an answer if this provision had been included as part of the constitution there. However, let me just answer this question. Now I'm spitballing here. Any provision under Article 35A as it stands today, if it was introduced as part of the Constituent Assembly, as the language says, you could not have challenged it on grounds of violation of what? Part 3. Right? But insofar as the other parts of the constitution are concerned, it is still available for the Indian state to get into and say, this has a problem for the simple reason that it impacts Article 1 itself and it impacts the first schedule itself. Therefore, why is this important? Now I'll give you another sequence of events. The Supreme Court was given jurisdiction over all issues relating to Kashmir. Okay, for a moment, let's assume this is the case. And that's what subsequently the Constitution said, that the Election Commission, the Supreme Court, all shall have jurisdiction with respect to Kashmir. Which means a provision under the constitution of Jammu and Kashmir, is it or is it not amenable to the jurisdiction of the Supreme Court insofar as violation of other parts of the constitution are concerned, assuming that that provision is immune from Part 3? That's the question. Now here you have to read three specific provisions. I'm sorry, I don't think I should say you should read. You should perhaps consider three other provisions. Article 363, Article 143, and Article 131. 363 is with respect to covenants and treaties entered into by princely states with the Indian Union. Okay. Then you have Article 143 and Article 131, which decide what is the jurisdiction of the Supreme Court with respect to covenants and treaties entered into by the Indian Union with rulers. The consequence of 363 is that the Supreme Court shall have only advisory jurisdiction insofar as treaties and covenants are concerned, and any disputes with respect to the instrument of accession entered into by a ruler with the Indian Union shall be referable only to the President. And the President shall refer the matter to the Supreme Court only for their advice, legal advice. So I could actually argue that if the state of Jammu and Kashmir says that any interference by the Union with respect to areas which can or cannot form part of the Constitution of Kashmir amounts to a dispute within the meaning of Article 363, that dispute is referable to who? They have submitted to the jurisdiction of the President of India and not the Supreme Court of India. In fact, may I just read out the provision for you? It may in fact answer your question in a very simplistic manner. Just hold on for a moment, because I anticipated this question, I kept this provision open. Bar to interference by courts in disputes arising out of certain treaties and agreements. This is Article 363. Notwithstanding anything in this Constitution, subject to the provisions of Article 143, as I said, neither the Supreme Court nor any other court shall have jurisdiction in any dispute arising out of any provision of a treaty, agreement, covenant, engagement, sanad, or ejus dim generis, or other similar instrument which are entered into or executed between the commencement, before the commencement of this Constitution, by any ruler of an Indian state and to which the government was a party. So this particular provision means, if tomorrow the Indian government has a problem with any provision of the Indian Constitution and it wants to escalate that particular issue before a court of law, neither can Kashmir do it nor India do it, but that matter is referable by way of a dispute to the President. That means the President acts as the arbitrator. Even that means what? You have recognized the Supreme Head, the Commander-in-Chief of India, as the final voice with respect to any dispute between you and the Union. What does it say? Then there is a recent, I think there's a judgment of the US court, Texas versus White. It's a very important judgment. And that judgment specifically says, why? Because they are not the Republic of United States, they are the United States of America, because they're all formed by, on the basis of the consent between the states. So perhaps if secession is possible and is easier, it must be easier in United States than in India, because India is an indivisible union of divisible units. That is our fundamental position as far as federalism is concerned. What does it mean? In that judgment, they have taken the clear position that any decision which is taken by a state which has a bearing on its accession to this particular union, to the United States, and which even amounts to secession, no matter what the rights of the state, will have to be struck down as unconstitutional. My point is, if a state in India, after having acceded to the Indian Union, decides to dictate the future course of demographics, it is against national integrity, it is against the Union's concept of federalism, and this is something that no state was ever given power over. You can have power over everything else, but not to say, this is exactly the proportion of the ratio that I'll maintain. Which means what? Let's assume for a moment, 76 and 24 was the percentage. Assume that the Hindu rate of fertility in Kashmir had suddenly exploded and the population demographics had changed. What would they have done? They would have de-recognized the third child and the fourth child, saying that you have produced more people, which alters the demographic balance of this particular state. Therefore, your first son will be a PRC, the second son will be a PRC, but the third child will be excluded. Would that be the argument? Not possible. So here I would simply apply the principle of logic, reductio ad absurdum. You test the reasonableness of a certain point of view by extending its logic and seeing whether it can survive in the extremes. According to me, it's absurdity. Next. I could be wrong for all you know. Which is why I have kept my ideology aside when I have discussed this. I understand, sir.
It is no, it affects the basic structure of the Constitution. It has to be deleted, forthwith or quashed, forthwith. It undermines the Constitution.
Fair enough.
It depends upon the identity of the judge.
Just to clarify,
the constitutional bench
Which is why, see, my point is, my ideological passion and proclivity have only pushed me into reading, but not in forming my views. I have allowed my training as a lawyer to dictate the course of my understanding of this particular issue. At least that's what I believe. Yes, please.
This Kashmir, from the time, you know, it got ruled by three families and all.
Yes, sir.
They also say that muzzle politics will not work. The third one, they say that, you know, it is a political problem.
Right.
So we are discussing more about the constitution. Is it a political problem or constitutional problem also? Just second one is the Amarnath Yatra is now curtailed. Troops are moved more now.
Yes.
Just why? What could be the guess for reasons?
So, to characterize this particular issue as only one type of problem, from what I've understood so far, would be unjust, and it would do injustice to the issue and the history of that issue. But to say that it has only a political angle, an economic angle, and a constitutional angle, but not the other angle which we don't wish to spell out, would be wrong. Okay? There is the other angle, which is the religious angle as well. And that is something that multiple commentators have recognized, because there is one interested party which wants to further the cause of the two-nation theory in that particular state. I mean Pakistan. Therefore, Pakistan is bound to try and find people in that particular state who stand by the point of view, who support the point of view. So to say that there is no religious angle at all in this, according to me, would be to take the position of an ostrich, dig the ground and then stick your head inside it. That makes no sense at all. So as far as I'm concerned, it is an important angle. And that angle has necessarily shown itself on a regular basis to the detriment of the minorities of that particular state. However, it is not entirely about religion. Of course, it plays an extremely important role when there are claims for establishing a caliphate in that particular state. So all that I don't deny. That it has provided a fertile breeding ground for all sorts of rabid elements is a different issue altogether. My point was, if you want to settle that particular issue, have legal and constitutional arguments by your side to make your case. Because tomorrow you'll have an article written by the New York Times as to how India is a fascist state which is suppressing the legitimate aspirations of the Kashmiri people by stifling their right of self-determination. That'll be the argument. You are preparing these arguments to shut those people up when they raise these questions and tell them we are not without legal arguments, we are not without constitutional arguments. We know what we are talking about. This is what I'm saying. I am not asking anybody to turn a blind eye to any other angle or any other perspective. However, India is backed by thorough legal arguments in making its claim not just for the existing portions of Jammu and Kashmir, but the entire historic state of Jammu and Kashmir as it existed under the Treaty of Amritsar in 1846. Sorry?
Meanwhile, keep our powder dry. The spirit's high.
Yes. As if you remove Article 35A and you bring in demographic balance, it'll automatically address Amarnath Yatra. Next. Yes.
Anyway.
Yes, sir.
54.
Yes, sir.
Born in 19.
Okay. Okay.
That all the parties and legal eagles were talking about only the Article 3.
Yes. Yes, sir. Yes. So the sad part about legal education is they don't teach you astrology or the ability to read people's minds.
Hello.
So I'm honestly not in a position to speculate and comment on what is the motivation behind the sudden springing up of Article 35A in public discourse. Maybe somebody sees a political incentive in it and hopefully they act on that incentive. I'm hoping that will happen. So that is the limited answer to that question, which is clearly political, which I don't think I'm required to answer here. All I'm trying to say is, whoever has any incentive, as long as that incentive leads towards better integration of India, I'm all for pushing that incentive. I don't have a problem. whatever may be anybody's incentive, as long as it brings people together and it destroys that bridge and destroys the barricade and makes it an indivisible, inseparable part of India, for me, that's enough. For me, that's where the means are perhaps override the ends. Point number two. Point number two is there are any number of judgments, according to me. Sir, whose phone is this? I think it's yours. Yes. Any number of instances where ordinances have been passed and legislative intervention has taken place during the pendency of matters. Okay? And if somebody wants to give the excuse that since the matter is effectively in the court of the court, there is nothing that I can do, I think the SCST Act, that amendment, will come back to bite them because I think they amended it when the matter was still in court. So there are examples where despite a court judgment, Indian governments have set aside the judgment through legislative intervention. There are examples where people, or rather Indian governments, have initiated legislative interventions despite the pendency of proceedings before the court. So I don't think there is any paucity of arguments or there is any paucity of precedents on that point. The fundamental question is intent backed by political will, backed by concrete arguments, backed by preparation and execution down to the T. That's it. Beyond this, there is really nothing. You have to decide whether you want to aspire to be a superpower with this issue hanging on your head for the last 70 years, because no superpower or no country which wants to be a superpower, I think, can ever aspire for it with this kind of a black mark and a blot on its record. I think that should not happen at all. You won't even be a regional power with this. I'm not saying therefore ride roughshod over everybody's rights. I'm not saying therefore you throw to the winds and the dustbin every legitimate consideration. But there cannot be any further arguments about who owns this particular place and to which particular country this land belongs. That's very clear. Kashmir belongs to India, and that issue cannot be the subject of any discussion at all. The question then is, what remains to be discussed with Pakistan? Nothing, according to me. No, nothing remains to be discussed with Pakistan. You are occupying. Will you sit and discuss trade with a trespasser of your home? What stupidity is that? But India cannot play, it can't play footsie on this particular issue. You can't blow hot and cold. You have a problem with that state, and you think that any slogan that is raised in support of that particular state amounts to sedition, then declare the country a terror country and declare the country an enemy country. You can't have it both ways, right? Take a decision, stick by that particular decision. Are you more dependent on sugar and onion that comes from Pakistan, or do you want Kashmir? That's the question. Next.
Sir, do you think the recent attempts of delimitation of...
I don't think a lady has had an opportunity to ask a question so far. Yes. I'll be accused of whatever I don't know, particularly given my position in Sabarimala. So the lady should ask a question.
Thank you.
Yes.
Sir, I just have a very simple question.
Yes,
in light of the recent developments with United States...
I am a bit hard on hearing. I have to admit that. So you'll have to speak louder. Yes.
Sure. I just have a very simple question, which is, in light of the recent developments with the United States offering a mediation, a possible mediation, what do you call or make of such a, possible suggestion? What do you think?
Americans don't take Trump seriously. I don't know why you're taking him seriously.
I'm not talking about only Trump.
Today, Mr. Dhruva Jayashankar on Twitter has put out a categorical statement through his tweet that if at all there is a discussion that is possible with Pakistan, that will be only a bilateral negotiation. And he conveyed this to Secretary Pompeo during the course of his discussions. He's put out a tweet on this. In fact, I was liking the tweet before the talk. So that tweet specifically, it says, Trump may say whatever he wants. He may resort to Twitter diplomacy. India knows that it has to deal with only one party here. According to me, that's not even Pakistan. That is only the people of Kashmir. You ensure that the people of Kashmir want to be with you, and then you ask Pakistan to vacate the place respectfully. Next.
Sir, do you think recent attempt of delimitation of constitutions will have any impact in eradicating Article 370?
I'm sorry, I didn't get the question. Somebody will have to. I'm sorry. Please repeat the question slowly. Yes.
Recent attempt of delimitation of constitutions in
Kashmir. Oh, constituencies. Okay.
Will have any impact in eradicating Article 370?
So, again, don't focus on Article 370, focus on Article 35A. A delimitation, according to me, of Kashmir could go a long way in limiting the scope of your attention and also giving other people of that region enough representation at the national level, and they should be given the place at the negotiating table, which they have been denied all these decades. So that, I think, would certainly help. But if there is a delimitation without removing Article 35A, would that be subject to judicial review as a legal question? Okay. And to be honest, on that particular angle, I have not done enough research. That's a question that I have put on the paper saying this is something that I need to consider. So on the question of the legality of a delimitation without removing Article 35A, the answer, I plead ignorance. I still don't know. That is subject to further research. Next.
Sir, along with Article 35 and 370,
yes.
Can the constitution of Jammu and Kashmir also be removed? And if so, how?
So that, I think, is the key question. That, I think, is the central question. Even if you remove Article 35A, you have removed a certain portion from your constitution. But what do you do about the constitution of Jammu and Kashmir? Now, here's the long-term strategy, according to me. And this should be the way it should be done, in my limited opinion. Removal of 35A will change the demographic character of that particular state. That means there will be more representatives in the assembly of Kashmir who are pro-India. Two, that could also mean Indian Muslims going there from the rest of India and raising pro-India voices. Why should it be only Hindus? Let's always be open-minded on that particular front. Because I saw some representations from Indian Muslims who have clearly said that 370 is a non-issue, that Kashmir is a part of India. That representation has also come. I've read something else. So when you change the character and composition of the legislative assembly of Kashmir, perhaps you can start looking at a possibility where they go back to the mode of the Constituent Assembly and say, why should we have a further constitution? Let us destroy ourselves and merge with India. But that is not possible as long as Article 35A stands in the way of greater integration. So Article 35A is a condition precedent. It is important, it is necessary, but not sufficient. That merely sets the ball rolling, according to me. But it is nevertheless an important issue, because that will change the attitude subsequently, that India will not sit silent on this issue further, and it will not allow somebody's hurt and, let's say, cottage industry to run at the expense of India and Kashmir. Okay? You've allowed a lot of people, a lot of families to benefit at this on this particular issue. You should read chapter 6 of that book of Mr. Jagmohan, where he captures how successive governments have used Article 370 to feather the nest of certain political families at the expense of the common people of Kashmir. How funds have been denied, or how real estate has been used to create 5-star properties at the expense of the common people of Kashmir. So according to me, there are enough and more justifications. You have to call out the bluff of these people by actually presenting facts as opposed to propaganda. And when facts speak for themselves, why do you want to use propaganda? You already have a good case. That's my simple point.
I think last three questions we can take because time is going up. Yeah.
Now, when you say people of Kashmir, who do you refer to? The valley? Now, okay. See, for anyone who is perhaps genuinely interested in being a part of a secular constitutional framework, I think he is the true minority in Kashmir. Because his voice, according to me, finds no genuine ventilation anywhere in any forum. And all the extreme voices, and I'm saying this without, let's say, based on my reading of sources, I've never been to that particular state, so I should caveat it. Which is why I said I cannot even remotely pass off as a commentator on Kashmir. These are my views as a student of law based on my reading of history. That's it. I suspect that the genuine people of Kashmir are the people who are genuinely pro-India and therefore pro-secularism and pro-constitution really have no options in that particular state. And when the coalition was formed, I think they shouldn't have formed the coalition. They should have allowed themselves to become the voice of such people and given them a potential political option, as opposed to being allowed themselves to be kicked around like a football and to come out ignominiously. So that, I think, is a mistake that was committed by the dispensation. If they had focused on cultivating that particular audience, even if not today, 5 years, 10 years, it will certainly pay. But when you're willing to deal with the devil and trade with the devil, I don't see what options you can get except the hell. How many more questions?
Two more. Two more. Yes, please. Yes. So, not that I have any problems with questions. Go ahead. Yes.
So the biggest takeaway from this discussion is the constitutional validity of Section 370 and Section 35A.
Yes, yes.
Now, given the situation, it's high time that we need to strike down these two law, these two particular provisions yes. of the Constitution.
Right.
Now that Article 35A is immune from judicial review under Part 3, you have suggested that it should be struck down on the validity of Part 2, that is the citizenship provisions,
yes,
or Part 20. Now, can you highlight or shed some more light as to which exact article on touchstone of which can you strike down 35A or 370? I'm a law student, I need it for my moot.
Okay, so if I have to answer the easier of the two questions, the lowest hanging fruit is striking it down for violation of 368 without even going down the path of Part 2, okay? Which is to simply say the procedure under 368.2 was not followed. And there was no amendment to 368.2 which allowed for such an amendment to be brought in through a presidential order. On that simple issue, you can finish it off, is my opinion. But that calls for revisitation of a constitution bench judgment of 1961. Therefore, if the government were to ask for a reference to a larger bench saying that there is a serious problem and that that particular judgment must now be revisited in light of Keshavananda Bharati, which is to say, okay, don't apply Keshavananda Bharati, don't treat it as part of basic structure. But you have other grounds to consider it, because basic structure or not, Keshavananda Bharati or not, you can always test the validity of an amendment or a legislative provision on the basis of 368.2, the procedure. That's it. That's one. Second, so apart from territory, you also define who are your people. Now, when you define who are your people, you have Articles 5 to 11 read with the Citizenship Act of 1955. The Citizenship Act is primarily, and if I'm not wrong, it is a central legislation. It's not a state legislation. There are no state-based amendments there. Perhaps state governments have a role when it comes to NRC and other things, but who is a citizen is to be defined by the central government, not by the state government. This is again subject to correction. Therefore, Article 35A is an anomaly by giving a state to define who shall be a citizen as far as that particular state is concerned. So it could be in violation of the Citizenship Act, apart from Articles 5 to 11, because you have a cutoff date, 19th of July, 1948, then subsequently. Then resettlement of people from Pakistan, all of this was discussed. In fact, Sheikh Abdullah wanted permanent residence or that category to be given to people who come back from Pakistan and who were originally people of Kashmir. Now that is being used to give PRCs to Rohingyas and also Uyghur Muslims from Xinjiang. Understand this. You've opened the state to everyone except Kashmiri Hindus. You've opened that state to everyone except Indians from the rest of India. How fair is this? So for me, the violation of Part 2 and Part 20 on the face of it is very clear. You bring in the Citizenship Act angle, I think it only complicates the matter more from the standpoint of anyone who defends Article 35A. I think the mandate is fairly clear there. Yes, next. Yeah. The only exception to 5 to 11 has been with respect to Assam, where the cutoff date was changed from 19th of July 1948, subsequently to the 1st of January 1966, and then extended to the 24th of March 1971 to decide who falls within the category of an illegal migrant for the purposes of setting up foreigners' tribunals under the Foreigners Act of 1946, and who needs to be expelled and included as part of the NRC. But no such exception has been made, at least with respect to Kashmir. Okay, next. Last question.
It's excellent discussion. After that,
I'm sorry, I made it extremely legal, but this was a legal question.
Excellent discussion after that exposure of all of us in that Sabarimala matter in Kashimath, Malleshwaram. Jam-packed audience were there here also. Your observation regarding 370 was excellent. That is infructuous, and 35A also how it can go. But there is one other issue which can help out in the matters. The ban on delimitation in Kashmir brought out by Farooq Abdullah government for 25 years. There is a ban on delimitation.
Right.
Now that your suggestion that governor is the person, he can remove the delimitation, that ban,
right,
and go for delimitation simultaneously with whatever you have observed, the 370 right. and 35A.
Right.
What's your take on that? Governor's power to remove the ban on delimitation. Yes, Farooq Abdullah has played fraud and put 25 years ban on delimitation. How it should go?
So I think he asked a similar question on delimitation. So the point, I think, and let me be blunt on this particular front, and I'm not someone who claims to know what he doesn't know. Specifically on this particular question, A high-level answer would be the president's power under Article 370 with respect to these kind of issues, I think would prevail over any other act undertaken by the state government with respect to delimitation if 35A were to be removed. I'm making that very clear caveat. Okay. However, I am not clear about the legality of Mr. Abdullah's amendment on the aspect of delimitation because I have not observed that particular document through the lens of 368, 370 or 35A. So I must plead ignorance on that particular front. But my big picture answer remains that this issue, since it is beyond the pale of part 3, if Article 35A itself is not immune to part 2, then any legislation that is brought about pursuant to Article 35A cannot also be immune from part 2 because it only draws its power from an already flawed and unconstitutional provision, which is Article 35A, unless and until he's able to trace the power for such a law to any other provision. Okay, there you will have to also look at the relevant provisions of the Kashmir Constitution with respect to the power of the Constituent Assembly to delimit itself or of the state to delimit itself. Okay, that is something that I have not applied my mind to on that particular issue. I have to be fair and honest on that particular front, but it's something that I'll certainly look into. So I have two questions. One question was your question, and the second is his
question. Yes. Sir, just last two more questions. I think they've been waiting for last 20 minutes, please.
Please. Go ahead.
Sir, as you mentioned, there are several stakeholders in the state. My question to you is, how can the Supreme Court say that because the Kashmiri Pandit exodus happened 30 years ago, we don't have time for them, but they have time for every other incident. They have time for Sabarimala, they have time for the 84 riots. Even we have international cases where the German courts are still...
I'm with you. I got the question. See, the thing is this, and there are so many lawyers here and they'll support me when I make the statement. Non-lawyers are better positioned to ask these questions than people in the profession. Because when you're part of this particular process, it comes with its own set of limitations. But I'm not known to be fettered by most limitations. But therefore, my point is, frankly, it was extremely disappointing and unfortunate that we are willing to even reopen murder cases after several years, the Jessica Lal case being a case in point. After multiple judgments and several processes of appeals, the court was willing to open it because it received a set of documents which were previously not before the court and because there was immense public pressure. Here, a minority of a particular state, which is effectively today a minority that has been kicked out, a better part of it, is asking for reopening of cases with respect to the murder, massacre, and genocide of its kith and kin. From a human rights perspective, which appears to be an extremely favorite perspective when it comes to Northeastern Kashmir, I think it's a blot on the record of India's human rights record. When the Supreme Court of the country says that perhaps these cases or too much time has elapsed for reopening of these cases. Now, however, here's a caveat, which is an important caveat. Have you read the order of the Supreme Court on this particular issue or is it based on mainstream reportage? Because if it is based on newspaper articles, I've realized, especially based on my own experience in Sabarimala, that they are not worth the paper that they are written on because you never know what the Supreme Court said and how it was twisted by the mainstream media. I'm going to caveat that very, very clearly. And that's one of the reasons that in almost every talk, I make it a point, an unconnected point, I make it a point to refer to Mr. Parasaran's arguments because the media was so disproportionate in its coverage of such an important issue that was argued over such a long period of time from the 17th of August to the 17th of July to the 4th of August. So I don't expect the media to be particularly accurate in its reportage of what exactly the Supreme Court said. So I think it's important to read the order. Is that what the Supreme Court said? And there are observations which are passed during the course of hearings. I'm not saying that you shouldn't take them seriously. However, assuming that the Supreme Court indeed said what you said, it has said, I think it is wrong. If we don't look out for these people, who will? They are citizens of India. India seems to have all the time in the world and the Supreme Court seems to have the time to entertain petitions with respect to Rohingya immigrants, illegal migrants. Surely it must make time for people of this country who have been massacred and who have been subjected to genocide.
Yes.
No, it's okay.
Right, let me
this is, has been a wonderful talk. Thank you so much.
Thanks.
My question actually relates to a talk that I recently went to this, where Mr. Sukrat Sanu says, India is still maintaining the colonial mindset in terms of a lot of things. In terms of Supreme Court, for example, it still follows the collegium, okay, which basically is following the English parampara and all of that. So my question here is, like, he made some solid arguments in terms of that, where the High Court and the Supreme Court only has to follow, like, the proceedings have to be in English, you have to follow the mylord and all of the curriculum, the actual
right
wordings that must be there.
Right.
So in this case, that basically brings me to the point that there needs to be certain reforms that must be done as part of judicial as well. As you've been in the profession for so long, what do you think would be appropriate at this point of time? What kind of reforms would you recommend? And this is primarily the question.
So if you really want to follow what the British are doing, then you must have a Judicial Appointments Commission, and that's a composite body, okay? So the funny part is, when it comes to some things, we want to follow certain traditions, and when it comes to something, we raise independence of judiciary. I don't know how that works. But be that as it may, regardless of who does what, it is possible to maintain the independence of judiciary despite having a Judicial Appointments Commission that has the say of the president and both sides, the opposition benches and the treasury benches. That's my position. Point number two, generally, I think it is important to reorient the compass in which we think about us. If you still think of us as part of the British Commonwealth, and that's how we operate, then there's a serious problem. You are an independent country with an independent identity, with a rich civilization, with such a vast literature of Indic legal jurisprudence that perhaps you must bring that to bear on your own decisions. And that is something that we must consider. But unfortunately, I don't think these issues garner any vote bank. Therefore, there is certainly no pressure on anybody to deliver on these issues. So we will continue to talk about these issues in air-conditioned, perfumed atmospheres, but to no end. People who are in a position to do something about it don't seem to bother about it, because for them the next election is what is most important. So that's it.
So Sai Deepak sir, yes, a few more questions are required if you don't mind.
I don't have a problem, sir.
Yep. Yes.
Sit down, sit down. Wait, please.
I'm better when I stand.
Yeah. So I have a question here.
Yes, ma'am.
I'm going to be more like the devil's advocate, and I may be hated for this.
Please.
If we were to talk about Article 35, this 35A, and we were to draw a parallel between 25 and 26 of the Constitution, and we talk about certain cultural and linguistic rights that have to be protected,
correct,
and if we have to probably court judgments like the Zoroastrian Society case, and if we were to have to court examples like Himachal, where an outsider cannot own property, etc., and put all these instances together and say, cumulatively, this is what 35A is all about, and therefore it is justified because we are talking about certain intrinsic rights of certain intrinsically unique communities in the valley.
Good. Now I'm going to give an extremely politically incorrect answer. Something which will open the floodgates. Something that I have not spoken on so far at all, and I have steered clear of it entirely during the course of my discussion. One, even if you want to protect it, and like a stuck gramophone, or what is the word now? I'll be in a loop, which is, it still violates 368, point number one. If such a provision has to be included, I think the parliament's consent must be taken, or it must effectively be the body that promulgates such an important change. That's point number one. Point number two, you don't have to go to Articles 25 and 26. You can simply go to Article 29, where the rights of cultural minorities are protected. That is something that you can fall back on. You take that argument for a moment, okay? What is the consequence of that argument? You're going to ask, then what is the communal identity of Kashmir? Are you willing to go down that path? I'll start answering the question. I am ready to answer the question. Because the identity of Kashmir, effectively, while it is composite, it is the seat of Shaivite Hinduism. And you've also had the Sharada Peeth there, where somebody from Kerala, Shankaracharya, walked all the way to that particular place. And that place lies in ruins in POK at this particular point of time. Okay? There is a reason why Kashmiri Muslims have surnames like Bhatt, Dar. There's a reason for it, right? In fact, one of the special police officers who was assigned to Mirwais Farooq, what was his name? Pandit. He was a Muslim with the name Pandit. What is the meaning of this? Look, you decide to go down this path, there is a decent chance that you may have to end up reading Rahul Pandita's book, Our Moon Has Blood Clots, in terms of what has happened to that place over successive generations. Okay, that's a question that you have to ask yourself. Are we going to saddle the current generation with historical excesses is the question that you'll ask. I am not going to say that. But surely it can't be your argument that the identity of Kashmir resonates with the identity of Pakistan. That would be extremely unfair. Pakistan itself is an artificial entity carved out of certain regions, which cannot claim to be the homeland of anybody claiming allegiance with the green flag. I'm sorry. I believe in the concept that historically all these places should have been part of one India. If it comes across as an ideological position or a fascist position or a saffron position, I don't care. That is the position. Okay? Point number two. This does not take away the promise of equality to all citizens, because that is not the civilizational impulse of this land. It is inherently democratic. It is inherently secular. The words, whether you choose Sarvadharma Sambhav or Dharma Nirpeksh, have existed in our lexicon way before somebody thought of secularism. And secularism as a concept has its origins in a Christian king being forced to choose between the Protestant denomination and the Catholic denomination, which is why it resulted in what we know as separation of the church from the state, because the question was, which church does the state stand by? Okay. So you have chosen to import those notions without understanding what are its origins. And have chosen to import the very same jurisprudence into India, which is why two words Ambedkar never wanted, secularism and socialism, right? So you cannot have a discussion on this particular issue without opening a few points. I'm happy to discuss all of those points, but I'm going to take the cue that I'm not expected to turn this into a political debate. But if somebody wants to have an honest discussion on this, the honest discussion would be, are you really saying that 76-24 has been the history of Kashmir? No, it has not been the history of Kashmir. I'll give you a different example. What is the difference? So, going by that logic, ma'am, Hyderabad should have gone with Pakistan. Largest princely state, Kashmir was the second largest princely state. Do you know how Hyderabad was populated? There's a beautiful book called The Last Nizam. You should read it. And that book effectively says how people from Yemen, Turkey, the Middle East, were brought. Hyderabad was at one point of time the leading place for Islamic jurisprudence, even before Egypt, because the leading seminaries came from that particular place. So there is a Hyderabadi biryani, you've heard of it? What is the origin of the biryani? Have you ever bothered asking? The Arabs in Hyderabad are given a name called the Chosh. That is the name of the particular community. They brought the biryani along with them. And there was also the Persian flavor to it. Okay. The personal bodyguards of the Nizam were not Indian Muslims. They were not Muslims from Uttar Pradesh or Bihar or any place. They were Yemenis. When he chose to run and flee, he ran to Turkey. Okay. Because they have extensive ties. Because at that point of time, the Khalifa was from the Ottoman Empire, known as the Ottoman Empire, when anglicized. And therefore, every Muslim empire necessarily needed the stamp of approval of the Khalifa. No wonder Tipu Sultan wrote to the Khalifa asking for a stamp of approval over his domain. Of course, he's a freedom fighter, is what we are told. That's a different issue. My point is this. This is a central discussion that must happen, not just with respect to Kashmir, according to me. You want a permanent resolution of all communal issues in this country, have an honest discussion, but that honest discussion will immediately be impeded by the blasphemy law 295A and 153A, wherein you can't hurt religious sentiments. How do you hope to have the guts to discuss anything when law comes in your way and it says free speech except the truth? I don't know then what is free speech. So India needs, and I've said this ad nauseum, ad infinitum in multiple places, a commission for truth and reconciliation to ensure that this remains the rainbow that it is. It remains the thali that it remains that it is. It remains the orchestra that it remains that it is. However, this is a discussion that is fraught with serious allegations. The moment you make this point, they'll brand you, they'll label you, they'll gag you, they'll stifle you, they'll silence you. You can't have this discussion. Remember one thing. I discuss the entire issue without touching on this aspect, making my case entirely on law. Waiting for a question such as this. Thank you for the question. Yeah, if they want to really talk about Kashmiriyat, then they have to open the whole thing. You can't have a discussion in silos. And I'm not saying the discussion must be had to say, look, 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 your ancestor did this, therefore you're equally evil. You want to make that argument, which community can claim to have not done anything evil at all? That's not the argument. But these discussions, the moment you have these discussions, they will try and say, oh, he's pushing towards this, matlab ye to us direction se aata hai, his allegiance is not to the Indian flag, but to one color in that flag. Immediately they'll push you there. And you say something else, oh, his allegiance is to the other color. Okay. You cannot have these discussions unless and until the society is mature enough to handle the truth. So what is that statement from that movie? A few good men, you cannot handle the truth. That's what he says, no? Sorry? Jack Nicholson, that's the statement he makes, no? You can't handle the truth. And effectively, I think India must say that at least at this point of time, notwithstanding the rights of free speech which have been carved out in Natya Shastra way before anybody thought of it, we cannot handle the truth today. That is the fact. Next.
Good evening, sir. I'm a first-year law student, so I'd like to commend you for such an enlightening speech.
Thank you.
So the questions being...
May I just make one clarification? This is very important. I wear this because I can't wear this to court. Because women can come in to court in saris. But if I were to wear the dhoti, the kurta, and the turban of Dior, I don't know what I'll be branded. So which is why I choose to wear this attire wherever possible. Even if it comes across as informal, for me this is Indian formal. And two, I am not an activist. I do not want to be branded as an activist at all. I am an Indian with very conscious and clear views on issues that concern me. That doesn't make me an activist. I am a lawyer first, or perhaps a human being first, an Indian second, and then a lawyer, but I'm not an activist. Because I'm very, very wary of that particular word called activist. Because an activist is so attached that they will never change their positions, even when counter logic and facts are presented. I'm not like that. Next.
Yeah. So the entire discussion of 370 and 35A, as you say, are between two parties, India and Jammu and Kashmir. Now, why is it that we are finding it so hard to negotiate with Jammu and Kashmir? Like, we can negotiate with Pakistan, Bangladesh, China, UNSC, etc., etc. But at four philosophies, Samaveda, Dandbeda, like, what stage are we right now and how should we exactly negotiate with them?
There's a beautiful white paper written by a Ladakhi and a member of, and someone from Jammu. And that white paper is, I don't remember the name of the white paper. I think they've hit the nail on the head by saying one or two things. One, people who supported the Muslim conference before accession, their proponents and supporters continue to exist in Kashmir. And people who support the national conference also existed. But over a point of time, you have allowed cross-border injection of poison over and over and over again, as a consequence of which, the balance in the society has tilted, and the proponents of Muslim conference today are the leading voices as opposed to the proponents of the original national conference. Let's assume that is the case for a moment. That has effectively made it so difficult, and coupled with that, you have certain establishments, which say we are media establishments, which constantly stoke and stoke and stoke because they earn their livelihood through this. And God knows who they are working for, what their motivations are, which is the deep state that is operating, what are the strings which are connected to them. But these vested interests have prevented an honest discussion, forget between government of India and government of Kashmir, or government of India and people of Kashmir, between people of Kashmir and the people of rest of India. That's a question that we have to ask. India has established its open-mindedness by opening its institutions through scholarships for people from Kashmir. Across the country, in every institution, you have at least one Kashmiri studying. Therefore, when India is willing to go this distance, I think this is more than half the distance. What is expected is drop the claim of succession. Be a part of India. You will always benefit when you're part of India. Pakistan has gone from bat se battar. Okay. And that is not the state that any right-minded citizen must be a part of. It is a democracy and a constitutional setup in name. Otherwise, it is a feudatory. It is a feudatory in the hands of a bunch of rogues. It's a feudatory state which is in the hands of a bunch of rogues. If you want to be represented by a bunch of rogues, you're doing grave injustice to the history of your own state and your own community. That is the argument. And that is something that you must present. But when you have Indian media itself pouncing on India and questioning the legitimacy of India, forget only Kashmir, where is the question of having an honest word? They will read the newspapers and they'll say, see, all the respected voices of Indian media, they support our claim. Therefore, we are right. That's how they go about it. Is that it?
Hello, sir.
Yes.
My question is goes something of this sort. With certain quantity of Kashmiris coming out in support of certain anti-social elements and the youth considering them as their role models, very much evident from the recent happenings, what do you think should be done to deal with this particular issue?
Unpopular answer, politically incorrect answer. India cannot be a soft state there. I am not asking India to be an armed state or, let's say, a police state, but it must necessarily use sedition laws and it must necessarily use whatever is needed to tell people, fall in line, otherwise India will not relent. That is something that India must not pussyfoot around at all. You want demilitarization of that particular place, then please change your attitude towards India. Only then that is possible. Accession has happened. There is no question of you moving away from India. This divorce is not possible. Neither will there be a talaq-e-biddat, nor will there be a proper talaq also. There is no talaq. This is a marriage for eternity.
Last question, sir.
Yes.
Last question.
Hello, sir. I am not a student of law, first of all. And with respect to 35A, Article 35A, why is it kept hidden? Like, why don't we find like 35A just like 51A? How we find 51A just after 51 or 50? 35A, we can't find it in the Constitution. It is find it in the somewhere in the appendix or something. Mm-hmm. And are there any other provisions which are just like kept like hidden or isolated, like 35A?
So if you take up any bare act of the Constitution, usually you don't find this. You have to go to the presidential orders, which are even in bare acts, you don't get them. Sometimes it's available only online. Okay. The funny part is, a good portion of my time on the subject was spent in collating the documents and putting them in a sequence, seeing what happened, when, and how. That is how jumbled up it is. Perhaps because I am doing it for the first time, I got it wrong. So I won't say that if I didn't get it right, then nobody can get it right. I won't make that statement. All I'm saying is, the simple question is, if there is any bare act with an amendment, typically after that particular provision, there is the amendment provision also. So 35 and then 35A has to come as part of it so that you know. But I didn't find so far a bare act which has 35A immediately after 35, so that people know what is the reality with respect to this. And look at it. You are more aware of Article 370 than of 35A. In general, even I was. That clearly shows that it's like this Trump election strategy. Create a stupid opponent and keep hyping him up and defeat him. And you kill the opposition that way. So you keep raising 370, 370, 370. According to me, it's a diversionary tactic. You're not looking at 35A because that is slightly more sensitive or way more sensitive than 370. So 370 se pehle 35A 35A needs to be addressed. And after that, anything can happen. Okay.
Yeah, I think we have come to the end of the session. Yeah.
Please, go ahead.
Sir, you mentioned about, some time ago, you mentioned about how important it is to burn both bridges as well as the barricade in Kashmir. I have been following up the Kashmir issue for more than two decades because coincidentally, I was born on the day the Treaty of Accession came into force.
I see. Okay.
My question to you is, today, passions are being stoked by different groups, be they separatists, the Indian Army, the armed forces, let me put it this way, or the Pakistan Army, all in the name of betterment of people of Kashmir. So in reality, it is nothing but a one-way bridge. Don't you think it's time we burn the barricade and retain the bridge and make it a two-way bridge?
How would that practically work? Explain. There's a decent chance that I am dense. So explain to me practically how would that work? What is the solution according to you? Retain 370?
My solution is, yes, in today's times, we have a lot of employment opportunities, a lot of educational institutions being set up in Kashmir, in the state of Jammu and Kashmir, as well as outside, so that the people of Kashmir can come out and
Come to the point. So therefore what?
Therefore, I think...
So hasn't India already established a two-way street by giving all these opportunities? Has India said that we will deprive you of the benefits?
That's not enough. You cannot have...
Okay, then what is the
You are having a lot of restrictions. You're having, you know, time and time again, you impose curfews.
May I just make this request? No. May I just make this request? I deal with specifics. So if you have a specific point to make, tell me, these are the restrictions that India has imposed without any justification, and this is the single biggest reason for hatred of India. Spell it out and I'll respond to it. Let's be very specific, point for point. Start. Go ahead.
No, I do not wish to...
No, ma'am, I'm saying when you make such a point, particularly on a sensitive issue such as this, the problem always is this, and this is not a personal statement. Generalities and platitudes and vague statements don't work. You will have to say something specific. You accuse somebody of something, can you say you're a bad person?
No, why I'm am not I bad accusing. Explain? I'm not accusing, I'm just talking
then
about
what is
reality.
It that India should do more than it has already done? Allow a plebiscite, allow a referendum, out of question. Next.
I'm just asking for a little more freedom for expression.
What freedom of expression are you talking about? Which is to effectively allow slogans against the existence of India? That is a non-negotiable. I will never buy peace or accept peace at the expense of dignity. You're already paying the price for it. That has happened in Delhi. Okay, you've come to that extent.
Why do you talk about burning the bridges? A bridge is most essential for
No, that. Not at all. The existence of the bridge, effectively, after a certain point of time, they'll say, 12 saal to ho gaye, wahan pe baith gaye, to ho gaya, permanent ho gaya. That's not how it's going to work. Sorry. Fine. That bridge has existed all along, and you have pampered vested interests enough. India must take a strong position. That is not the same as saying that you must crush all voices. But you must certainly tell voices that an anti-India position will have consequences. And after the instrument of accession and after the Kashmir Constitution of 1956, no statement of accession is legal. Forget ethical or moral. It is seditious, period.
Yes, I think we have to end the session.
Of course, this is again subject to whether the law of sedition applies to Kashmir. That's a different issue. Huh.
Yeah, Mr. Samad would like to say something.
Samad Khan.
Yes.
My name is Samad Khan. For me, there is five groups have been formed by Muslim intellectuals in India, out of which, for southern part, they have appointed me. We all prepared a white paper in this contest 370 and 35A. Why? Because Kashmir is an integral part of India. It will be Indian integral part. No one can touch, no one can. Why? Because my forefathers have given this beautiful nation to me. It's my nation. It's my privilege. I have to keep up the dignity. I have to keep up everything. So it is injustice. We have told clearly in our white paper, we submitted to the President of India. Yes, in 1951, when 15 intellectuals returned to the UN, now we, last 15 days back, we have organized a beautiful program in Bangalore, Mangalore, Mysore, where several hundreds of Muslim intellectuals have written to the President. It is between you and the Jammu and Kashmir. You people sorted out your differences and clear, take that people to the nation and build this beautiful nation strong and strengthen, as our Prime Minister says, Vasudeva Kutumbakam. We all learned Asatoma Satgamaya, Tamasoma Jyotirgamaya, Rutyorma Amrutangamaya, Home Shanti Shanti Shantihi. So what we learned from this beautiful land, our forefathers have given this beautiful land in a diversity, in all cultures we learn together, we stay together. India Jamuni Tehzeeb Kabhi Bhi Baki Rahegi, Ham Hindustani, Aapas Mein Bhai Bhai Hain, Ye Jammu and Kashmir, Hamara, Hamara, Hamara Hai, Ye Hindu Ho, Muslim Ho, Hamara Sab Khoon Ek Hai, Hamko Koi Bahar Wala, Hamko China Se, Dusre Countryon Se, Hamko Koi Dar Nahi Hai, Hamari Tarakhi. I am very thankful to the people of this nation. We elected a powerful government where always the vested interest, always the parties have ruled. This minorities, 20% of minorities, as per the Sachar community, they told. It is there, they are so behind, so worst. Why? Because they made as vote bank. Now I am thankful to this beautiful government, which is really making all efforts to bring this community to mainstream. I hope our Prime Minister, the political setup will bring this Kashmir also to with us as a brotherhood, and they develop our nation. We are the superpower of the nation. We rule the nation, as my Prime Minister presented. Same thing, we all are the rulers of this globe. we have to, Vasudeva Kutumbakam, yes, we will prove it. As my friend told, Sai Deep has kept very nicely, we are not the society where we are going to clinch something. We are the society, our blood is so clean that we will go with consensus, negotiations, and peace and harmony. In that, we'll prevail, we'll remove this 317-35A, which is barbaric, which is no way it is justifiable. We have to throw it out. It is between the president, it is between the government and Jammu and Kashmir. We all support this cause to remove, and we all are one and one. Jammu and Kashmir also our brotherhood, it is also our state. Everywhere an Indian should go and have business. Due to this sections, they are getting loose. I visited on 26th and 27th, we presented this white paper with all the groups. We went there and we presented to the president to remove this all barbaric things. Now we hope this discussion went in very positive way. I'm very thankful to our senior and our Basavaraj sir, our senior sir, and Sai Deep, who made such a beautiful dialogue to us. I'm very happy. I'm thankful to Diksha Legal, which is doing wonderful in our judicial system. Thank you, sir.
Thank you very much, Abdul Samad sir. He's the national member of core committee of, he's the national member of core committee of white paper on Article 370 and 350A of Constitution of India. I request Mr. Gautam to honor him with a bouquet, please, to Mr. Abdul Samad. Yes. Yes, yes. And also to our Bar Council member, Mr. Gautam Chand. Sir, you can't be. Please, it's our honor to honor you, please. And of course, to Madam Anu Changappa, please. She is the president of Lahari. Yes. Yes. No, madam, you can't say that. Yes. It's our honor, please. To honor you is our honor. So I think we have come to the end. I request Mr. Nitin Basavaraj to come and give the vote of thanks.
It is my privilege to offer a vote of thanks to each and everyone who have made this seminar a memorable moment. Thank you.
Thank you all. Good night. And